For our new viewers, what that means is in 5 minutes you will be treated to a live safari. But for these five minutes, I suppose, same thing. For these 5 minutes, you get to see us talk inanely for a little while, test out our stream, and all in all, have a jolly good time. Ouch, something just flew to my eye. Now, on the back with me is Dave, returned safely from leave. In fact, we have had a mass entrance back into camp. Miss McLennan Smith's voice is back in my ear, so Kirsty is back. Baby Impala, it's your first Baby Impala. Kirsty, would you like to see a Baby Impala? Look at that Baby Impala. Oh, never mind. There was a Baby Impala. It's now hidden behind all three adult Impala. Oh, there's one in the road. Ha ha, you little, two little ones. Two little monsters. There we go. Kirsty is back from leave. Lou is back. And Connor is back. All in all, it has been a mass return. Taylor will be back at some point. Taylor missed her flight, but she will be returning as well to us at some point in the not too distant future. I'm not entirely sure when. One very confused looking male impala. The young male impala, who are a year old and have never seen a baby since they were babies, are completely flummoxed by the influx of new babies. It's highly entertaining to watch. The little ones. Hello, little monsters. Of course, Dave, you've missed out on some extraordinary sightings, as one always does when one is on leave. We have had many lovely sightings with the royal family, and last time I haven't spent as much time with Hassan as I have with Shungile. The last time I saw Shungile, she had her mom's baby, I assume her mom's baby impala kill, and she was playing with it. It was one of the most entertaining sightings I've ever had with her. And I have to say, it has been, Dave, you've missed out. It has been such a pleasure over the last few, actually really in the last few days, getting to know Shungile properly and to really see her grow into the character that she's going to be. Just been full of courage, she's full of curiosity, she's full of playfulness, and in my opinion, looks a great deal like her aunt, Tundi. And it's the most extraordinary privilege. And how on earth I'm going to describe where it is, I don't know, but it is carrying some nesting material. It's the one bird we have not found a nest for. Yes, that marula tree, but where? Oh dear. It was somewhere at the back, Dave, and we're facing straight into the... Oh, there goes something. There it goes. Now it's gone into the other marula tree. Oh, there's another one there. That's plum-coloured starling. How lovely. Here you go, getting two sneak peeks at the birds you might see in the not-too-distant future. I'm sorry, I think it's now called the violet-backed starling. Welcome back, Dave. Here, have two small invisible birds in your first 5 minutes. have three running baby impala and two invisible birds, just to make sure you haven't forgotten how things work. Is it good to be back? Should I find us some elephants rather? You did a great job though, well done. Well done, well done. All feel rusty when we've been on leave. It's a strange feeling. If you're one of the presenters. Oh, goodness, that went fast. Oh, I'm not going to go into the details of all the rest of the crew. It's about to start.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to a sweltering South Africa for your sunset safari, and this is Safari Live. Ready?
Standing by.
One.
You are live.
Welcome. As I said, it's a sweltering day here in South Africa. It's about 95 Fahrenheit, 35 Celsius. My name is Brent Leo Smith, and on camera with me is Jandre, and who's spotted a bird of prey. Let's try and get a little bit closer. I didn't have a good look, I just saw some dark wings head in there. Now remember, this is live, so it might escape, it might sit, you never know. Remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you want to ask us any questions about what is happening here in the Greater Kruger National Park. Or if you're wondering about, oh darn it, but I'm going to go quickly. General size, shape and impression. And coloration. So quite often with birds, you got to be quick. I'm pretty sure I know which one that is. Let's see if he's landed a little bit up ahead. He's a bit nervy there. And so as far as I know, we've only seen that eagle once or twice so far this summer. It is one of the migrants. And it was the last of the migrants. Last of the migrants to arrive. And oh, he's just on the move again. But while he's on the move, a big welcome to our schools for this afternoon, who are joining us for their very own private safari. It's Windsor Woods, Windsor Oaks, you guys are trying to get me confused, and Creed Elementary Schools. So great to have you back on the vehicle. And Jandre has spotted a gorgeous kingfisher. It is called a woodlands kingfisher. Here we go, and you see that lovely electric blue. Now, when you say kingfisher, you would expect this bird to be next to a pan or a body of water. But not all kingfishers eat fish. This is an insectivorous kingfisher, so he eats bugs and frogs and lizards, and is quite often does a lot of his feeding away from the water. Now see how he's opened his beak like that? That's because it's swelteringly hot today. And if you look carefully at his throat, he's inhaling very quickly. That is called a gula flutter. It's a bird's air conditioning system. So they bring air quickly over the blood vessels in the tongue to cool the blood down. Okay. Hello, Amaya. Amaya would like to know, what are the types of birds in South Africa? Well, Amaya, there are too many to list, but I'll list a few. Kingfishers, wood hoopoes, hoopoes, barbets, cisticulas, flycatchers, ducks, geese, waders, plovers, lapwings, hornbills, hawks, buzzards, and lots and lots and lots and lots more. So there are lots of different bird species. There are about 700 different individual bird species in South Africa alone. Okay. Now, we're looking for any animals, but it is quite hot, so they might be hiding from us. So we might have to move quite a distance. But while we keep searching, we're going to go meet one of the other members of the team who's out to take you on your very own private safari walk.
Good afternoon, everybody, from the Windsor Oaks, Windsor Woods and Creeds Elementary Schools. My name is James Hendry, and on camera today we have Brian. Brian?
Hello.
You seem to have something painted on your thumb.
Yes.
It's a piece of toast, isn't it, Brian?
It's a burnt toast.
Oh, burnt toast, and something has had a bite out of it.
Yes.
How very strange.
How very strange.
Good. Indeed. Now, we're going to be going on a walk for this afternoon. And while we're walking, we're going to be looking for little things like insects and perhaps some birds and tracks. That's the footprints that the animals leave. And maybe something bigger. Maybe we'll find an elephant. Maybe we'll be lucky enough to see a cat. So that's the team on walk today, except to introduce you to a man called Herbert. And Herbert is a long way away over there, and he's a tracker. He's a very, very fine tracker, and he's looking for animals while we over here. Mitchell, You want to know what animals we see the most of? Well, on walk, like with everything else, the most common animal that we see is the impala. And that's a little antelope, a bit sort of about the size of a white-tailed deer, I imagine. That might give you a bit of an idea of how big it is. Now, just look at this tree. I didn't start behind this bush for the sake of it. This is a bush called Combretum imberbe, or the leadwood. And the important thing to note about this whole little thing here is that this bush is an ecosystem. There are lots and lots of things living in it and on it and underneath it. So there are ants living inside the bush. I saw one recently just walking along. Here we go, Brian. There's some ants on the leaves there. Can you see them there? Some special ants. Here's a bigger one. There's a wasp there. You see the wasp? Did you see it vaguely at all? There it is. That's a wasp. So there's some ants there. And then, of course, you know, a big bush like this provides shade. And that means it's not the only thing growing here, because it gets very hot out here, you know. So here is another bush growing underneath the shade of the big leadwood tree. And what you can see is that this bush here has been eaten. It's been devoured. Something has eaten it. And I suspect it was probably a caterpillar of some kind that's had a go here. Then, living around this bush, look at this very nasty hole that we have over here. This, everybody, is a scorpion's hole. Now, I bet you all know what a scorpion is, and I bet you, if you're very clever, you'll be quite nervous of scorpions, because scorpions can be very nasty. And this is called a burrowing scorpion. You all know what a burrow is. It's a hole in the ground that something lives in. And this scorpion likes to eat things called millipedes. And a millipede is a sort of long, it's not an insect, but it's an invertebrate. It's like a big worm with lots and lots of different legs. And those are the exoskeleton of the millipede. Now, what we're going to try and do is just see if we can get the scorpion to put his hand out here, just so that you can see him. Evan, while we do this, you want to know how many bugs we normally see on walk? Evan, we don't normally see many bugs. Well, in fact, we do. But the most, I suppose, it's difficult to say how many, because, you know, if we go to a termite mound or an ant nest, there could be millions and millions of them. Now, what I'm doing here is I'm just irritating him slightly. He's going to think that this is something to eat. Jonathan, you're obviously a very clever fellow, because you want to know if bugs migrate. I'm just going to stick my head in there, Brian, to see if I can see it. No, I don't know that this guy's at home. I think he's not at home anymore. Anyway, that's his... Oh, let's just quickly try once more. Now, what we do is we pull this out very slowly, and he holds it, you see, because he thinks it might be something to eat. No, I don't think he's home. Anyway, that is the burrowing scorpion. Jonathan, you want to know if any of the animals here migrate or any of the bugs migrate. Believe it or not, Jonathan, they don't here, but they do in your part of the world. You've probably heard of the monarch butterfly, and the monarch butterfly moves in huge numbers from Mexico all the way up, I think, to the northern parts of the United States. I think that's what the monarch butterfly does in your part of the world. That's a very, very good question from you. Right, on we go. It's about 35 degrees Celsius out here, which is around about 93 degrees Fahrenheit. So it's quite hot. You can see lots of cloud has come over the sky, and that's quite nice for us because it's nice and shady for us. So we're going to head down towards where Herbert is tracking. We'll hopefully find something interesting for you. And while we do that, go and meet my friend Jamie Patterson.
Hello and welcome to the Sunset Safari, and a very warm welcome to all of the schools joining us this afternoon, Windsor Oaks, Windsor Woods, and of course Creed Elementary. As James said, my name is Jamie, and it is my pleasure to have Dave on camera with me this afternoon. Hey Dave, welcome back Dave. And we're starting off with one of my favourite antelope. Hello little boy. Now this particular antelope is called a nyala, which is actually kind of somewhat of a difficult word to say. Nyala, N-Y-L-A-L-A, nyala. And this particular one is a teenage boy. The female Inyala are the colour of the stockings on this male Inyala's legs. The males are a sort of a dark browny-grey colour, and this little guy is somewhere in between. You can see he started to grow his horns, and antelope grow horns from when they're a couple of months old. They'll start to grow up from the top of their heads. The amazing thing about those horns is that those are solid bone. What are you doing, you silly boy? Have you got an itchy nose by any chance? I think he was using that branch to scratch his nose. And of course, they've got that beautiful fur coat with the white stripes and the dots down it. You can see him stepping delicately along. Jacob! Hello and welcome. I hope you're having an amazing time. You want to know what my favorite animal is. Oh, Jacob, it's always so hard to choose, but I think if I had to, I'd probably say a black rhinoceros. I also really love elephants. Elephants I do enjoy spending time with, but it's hard to choose. I love spotted hyena. I can't choose. I love all of the animals so much. Dave, what's your favorite?
Elephant.
Dave says his favorite is elephants. What's your favorite, Joshua? What are your favorite animals? I would love to hear. Because, of course, all of my favorite animals are... Jacob, what are your favorite animals? Because all of my favorite animals are African animals, but maybe there's some animals from where you live that you might like just as much as I like elephants and rhino. And it would be lovely to hear. So let me know what your... Jacob, let me know what your favorite animal is. I've never seen a bear, for example. I would love to see a bear. And Hayden, you want to know? I'm going to try and get you another view of this particular young antelope because it's a good question. You want to know, how do we tell how old an antelope is? It can be quite difficult and you can't always do it accurately. The reason that I know that this is a young antelope, and he's probably only about a year, maybe just over a year old, is because I know how fast young Nyala grow. So I know from when they're born and when they're babies, and I know how quickly they grow and when they start to grow their horns. And it sometimes takes them, and in fact for most antelope, it'll actually take them years for their horns to reach their full size. And it's usually between 4 to about 6 years that it takes them for the horns. Now, in the Nyala's case, when he's fully grown, when he's about 4 years old, his horns are going to go all the way back and then curve upwards. But he hasn't quite got to that point yet. He's still in that teenager stage. He's still got lots of growing to do. But it is difficult, and you can't always tell how old an antelope is. As they start to get older, sometimes they get a bit scruffy looking, and their teeth wear down. And Kate, you want to know, how long can Inyala live? Usually around and up to 10 years, but they can live a little bit longer as well, Kate. The thing is, it's a tough life out here, and there are lots of predators, lions, will eat Inyala. So obviously the average age is very dependent on that, with all of the scientific study that goes into it. Not all of the Inyala live up to their old ages. But if you had an Inyala in captivity, it could probably live over just over 10 years or so. Some of our animals can live a really, really long time. Elephants, for example, can live up to 60, even 70 years if it's a really, really old elephant. But usually between about 45 years old and about 50 would be the normal age for an elephant. Tortoises can live 70 years easily, so almost basically as long as a human being. So there are lots of animals that live a very long time. Look at this. No, don't go. It's okay. It's all right. Look here. Look at this tiny little baby. Here you go. Here's another good example of how you can age antelope. This little one is only a few days old, and the male behind it is about a year old. So his horns have grown only as much as they will have in a year. But how cute is this little baby impala? Now, the amazing thing about these antelope is that they can run around and stand about 20 minutes after they're born. So not like a human baby that needs caring for and takes about a year to walk. Look, it's still wobbly. It's so huge. Sam, you wanted to know what antelope eat. They eat plants. They are herbivores. Some of them eat grass, but most of them will eat a mixture of grass and of plants, so of leaves of trees and bushes and shrubs. No, little one, that's not your mommy. That's not your mommy, and he's going to headbutt you if you go too much closer. Your mommy is not him. Is your skin itchy? Oh, you're so cute. So although it can already stand and walk and run, it's still a little bit wobbly. And I saw a baby impala fall over this morning. So they do fall down every now and again. But isn't it amazing that they are able to jump and to run only a few minutes after they're born? Look here. Oh. Oh dear. I told you were going to get a headbutt. Yes, there's your mom. Stay with your mom. Lily, you want to know if baby impala are born with horns to protect them? No, they're not. Because otherwise they could actually seriously hurt their mommies. So their horns will only start growing after a few months is when the baby impala will start. You'll see them start to stick through. And for impala, it will only be the boys that grow horns. So if we look at the baby's mom, see, she doesn't have horns at all. Even though she's fully grown, she's a fully grown adult, she doesn't have any horns. And some female antelope do, but in female impala they don't. Yes, there's your mummy. You're going to go drink some milk? No, not just yet. Now, there are all sorts of creatures out here, and sometimes we have all sorts of fun imitating them, and it sounds as though Brent is doing his best impression of a monkey.
Okay, so there's lots of different animals, but just as important as the animals are the trees. Now, I'm in a very interesting tree, quite high above the ground at the moment. Now, this is called a tamboti tree. Now, this tree is eaten by very, very few animals, and the animals that eat it for medicine. So it's highly, highly, highly poisonous, but if they've got bugs like tapeworms or flukes in their stomach, they'll eat the poisonous leaves of the tamboti tree to get rid of all the bad things. And it can be also used in human medicine, but I'm going to have to come down the tree, hopefully I don't fall out, to show you what I mean. Oh dear, this is quite high. But fortunately, I descended from monkeys, so I still have some tree climbing skills left, one would hope. Oh, maybe not. Okay. Let's just take. You gotta be very careful. So touching the bark is fine, but when you take the leaves, you have to be very, very careful. So I'm gonna pull one leaf off, and I'm gonna pop it. Ooh, gotta be careful. Down there. Ooh. Let me turn it around for you now. Now, look at that. You can see there's a white, milky substance coming out of that leaf. Now that's where the poison is. Now this poison is so strong that even when the tree is dead, that poison stays in the wood. And if you had to cook on it, and you made a fire and you made a nice barbecue or cooked a nice stew on it, you would get really, really sick just from the smoke. The poison will go into the smoke and into your food. But it is a very, very cool tree, and it's a very important tree. So baboons, giraffe, black rhino, kudu will all eat this when they've got something wrong with their tummy to try help clean the system out completely. So it is a very important tree. So sometimes poisonous trees can also be good. For human beings, the poison is actually used for toothache. If you've got really, really bad toothache, you've got to be very, very careful with it. They'll put it right into where the hole is in your tooth, and it'll actually sort of kill your nerves completely so you can't feel any more pain. So like a root canal by bush root canal. I wouldn't recommend it though. If you can go to the dentist, I would. So we're sitting in a dry riverbed at the moment, and we're gonna keep moving. Now, dry riverbed's always a good place to look for animals on a hot day, because you've got lovely trees like the Tambuiti that offer shade. Now, another thing you might see in this type of area where you've got these nice big trees on the side is monkeys. And Grace was asking, do we usually see monkeys? Well, Grace, this is a good spot to look for monkeys. So we will try keep a lookout for them. We saw some monkeys near here earlier today. But if you have a look carefully through this area, and you can see where the river flows when it flows, where it's deep here. And then we've got what's called a primary floodplain to the left, and then above a secondary floodplain. So this primary floodplain, you can see there's not too many big trees, and there's still quite a lot of sand. So this is where a normal flood would go, but we're going to drive around to take you to the secondary floodplain. And while we do that, let's go back to James, who's wandering around on foot.
And one of the things we find out here that are very special are the grasses. Now, I know that many of your mothers will like flowers, and if your father's very clever, he will be giving your mothers flowers very often. Otherwise, he will be in what is known as the dog box. This here, everybody, is a gorgeous, gorgeous piece of grass. And grasses often in Africa are used instead of flowers because they're so very pretty. And this one, I actually don't know the name of. I'm not sure I've seen it before, but it's very pretty, you can see. And let's see what it tastes like. Mmm, it's very nice. Now, many of you will also have seen people walking with grass in their mouths. This is because it helps you to think. I always walk around here with a piece of grass in my mouth because it helps me to think. Now, down here, we have one of the most special kinds of flowers here because it survives a very long time, and it's called Waltheria. Doesn't have an English name. It's called Waltheria, and it's yellow, and what you can see is that it's got a number of different kinds of pieces on it. Well, those little pieces give rise to something called a camouflaged mantis. And the mantis likes to hide on these plants. He looks exactly like one of the flowers. And can you guess what he eats from watching this flower? Can you see where I'm pointing now, Brian? Mm-hmm. Can you see the ant there?
We did.
There, he's just here he comes. He's on the top of the leaf now. There he is. Now that ant that you saw, and there you see now, you see he's wandering around here looking for nectar to drink from the flowers of the Waltheria plant. And if the mantis is around here, and I can't see a mantis here now, he looks exactly like the flower. And so what the ant does is he tries to get some nectar out of the mantis, not realizing that he's a mantis, and then he gets eaten. So it's really very clever of the mantis to look like the flowers. They're predators. They love to eat delicious ants. Ants taste a little bit like they taste a little bit like lemon sometimes. Some ants taste like pepper and others taste like lemons. Isn't that nice? Now, one of you wanted to know what season it is here. Well, if it's 35 degrees Celsius, 93 degrees Fahrenheit, Shannon, it's not anything other than the middle of summer. It's very hot here, Shannon. And we need to make sure that we have enough to drink when we're out here in the wild. And so what we do is make sure that we have sufficient to drink. Maya, yes, they are. You're very clever. You said, are some of the flowers poisonous here? Absolutely, they are poisonous here. And we need to be very careful. You must never in the wilderness put anything in your mouth that you don't know how to identify. So if you don't know what it is, then you mustn't put it in your mouth. Now, I don't know what this grass is, but I know that none of the grasses here are poisonous. But for example, if I was to find something like this plant here that I'm pointing at with my stick, I don't know what that is. And so I wouldn't dare put that in my mouth because it might make me sick, and that would be very, very dangerous indeed. Now what we're going to do is walk along what we call a drainage line. Now a drainage line is a dry riverbed And we're going to walk along it because sometimes you find very interesting things there because there's quite a lot of shade. And that shade means that animals like to hide there, and the trees mean that birds like to live in these drainage line areas. So we're going to go down through here and then we'll show you over the top into this dry riverbed. And you can imagine that at some stage in the history of this great landscape, there would have been water flowing through these rivers. But now it's very dry, it's much too dry. And so it's highly unlikely that it's going to produce any water. What we're going to do is just look over the top here. See, look at that. And I can't see any animals, but Brent Leo Smith thinks that he might have something extremely special to show you.
Well, it extraordinarily went behind a bush. We're going to try and get another view. There was a female impala who was displaying some sort of early signs that she might be about to give birth. Now, quite a few of them would have already given birth, but some of them haven't yet. Well, speaking of one that already has given birth, there are not too many of the females that haven't given birth yet. And that's why I was just watching carefully. You can see there's a baby and a mom. So a baby's probably a couple of days old at the oldest. Hello, little guy. Now, I can't see that female who was looking like she was about to give birth at the moment. Yes, there she is. That's her. You can see her tail's up quite a bit. I'm going to just try hang around here. Hopefully she doesn't stop behind a thicket, which I think she has. There she comes. You can see how her tail's sticking out, not sitting down low. I'm just trying to watch the side of her belly for any movements. Sometimes you can see the babies kicking. See if she's showing any signs of contractions. Okay, well, we're going to keep a close eye on these impala. While we do that, James has got a bird of prey to show you.
This is very, very, very special, everybody. There's a Wahlberg's eagle. That's what that is there, sitting very close to the ground. And in the background, you might just be able to hear Franklin's. They're like little bush chickens that run around the bush here, and what they're doing is alarm calling. So they're calling, pacha, 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 because they're very afraid of the Wahlberg's eagle. They think the Wahlberg's eagle wants to eat them, and they're not wrong. The Wahlberg's eagle would happily eat them, but normally that eagle likes to eat things like lizards, and sometimes small birds, but often small mammals like mice or gerbils out here. And what I think he's looking for is a lizard, because those termite mounds, you can see that he's living next to, or he's standing next to a termite mound. That's a big mound of soil there. And often in the termite mounds, not only termites live, of course, but lots of lizards and things live inside them. Now, this Wahlberg eagle we know very well. It's either the male or the female of a couple that lives not far from here, and I think they're looking after some eggs. Gianna, while we look at this eagle and try and figure out what on earth it's trying to do, you want to know if we get lots of eagles here or if they're rare. Gianna, they're not very rare. We do see nice eagles here in protected areas, but I suspect, much like in America, they are rare outside of game reserves. So we're in a reserve where people don't really live, and so here there are lots of different kinds of eagles, and I'm just going to quickly tell you about them. There's the Wahlberg's eagle, there's the lesser spotted eagle, there's the steppe eagle, the marshall eagle, the fish eagle. The brown snake eagle, the Batalea eagle. What else have we got? Well, probably most of them. Oh, yes, and the African hawk eagle, too. And the tawny eagle. So we've got lots of different kinds of eagles. But that one is very special because they always come back to the same nest every year and they don't live here all the time. And Sam, you've picked up on a very interesting point here. You say, are birds this size always this close to the ground? I've never seen one this close to the ground. I have seen one once or twice eating on the ground, but not sitting relaxed on a sort of branch waiting there this close to the ground. I'm sure it must have seen a lizard or something going into this termite mound, and I think he's probably patiently waiting to see if it doesn't come out. And you can see him turning round. He's looking towards the Franklins, the little bush chickens that are shouting at him. And Richie, we've got your very good question. This bird, this eagle will eat other birds if it can catch them, but it's not a specialist in eating other birds. The eagle that we have here that eats other birds the most is something called an African hawk eagle, and they hunt in pairs. And so what happens is the male flies high up above and the female a little bit lower. And they love to eat Franklins and guinea fowl. Those are the sorts of birds they like to eat. And while the male is flying up and the guinea fowl are watching, going alarm calling, the female comes climbing in from low down and she'll nail one of those little bush chickens and then they'll eat it and they'll be very happy indeed. This guy is looking for something. Now, Shannon and Miss Frederick, you're wondering about how this eagle manages to breed. Well, Shannon, this particular eagle does indeed lay eggs. All birds lay eggs. Every single bird in the world lays eggs. And this particular one lays only one egg at a time. Many eagles lay two, but this guy only lays one egg at a time. And then they raise the chick, the male and the female, together. Now, what often happens with eagles is that if they then lose that chick, they might try again that year, but sometimes they'll wait again to next year. And these chaps go off into North Africa for much of the season. So when it's winter here, they're in North Africa. They're not down here in Southern Africa. And then they come down here to breed. They normally arrive here around about August time. Some big eagles, like, for example, the black eagle, which is an enormous eagle, will lay two eggs, but then something very unattractive happens. When the first one is born, it eats the food that the mother brings, and then when the second one is born, the first one normally kills the second one. And so the second egg is almost like an insurance policy in case the first one doesn't survive. That's something called siblicide. Alrighty, we're going to stand here a little bit longer with this little bird, or quite big bird actually, it's about that big. While we do that, Brent is still with the pregnant impala. Let's go and find out if she's going to have her little lamb.
Well, she's moved into the thickets, and you can see there's actually two of them there. Unfortunately, this is the best view we've got at the moment. I don't want to put any extra pressure on them, so we're keeping our distance as they slowly move parallel to us. Now, impalas will generally give birth in a little bit of a thicket, which can make viewing the bird sometimes a little bit difficult. Tristan. Tristan would like to know if I've seen any animals give birth before. Well, Tristan, on the live drives, I think we've seen wildebeest, zebra give birth before. I haven't seen a live birth before, but in all my years in the bush, I've seen lots of different births. I've seen impala, elephant, giraffe, kudu, wildebeest, zebra. I've seen quite a few impala birds as well. I'm just trying to see if I can get another view of them as they're moving through the thickets. See, there might be a gap through here. Okay, I'm hoping they're going to move forward. While they're moving forward, I'll keep an eye on where they should pop out. There's some other animals here. Hello, fluffy waterbucks. Here we go, there's some waterbuck. Catherine's wondering, how many babies do impala have at once? Well, normally one. Twins are very, very rare, but so normally one. So these are female waterbucks. The males have horns. And you can see the one at the back left. Oh, there's a male. Oh, he's crossing the road. He's going to walk around shortly. There, that one has already had a drink. You can see the wet lips. So it had a drink at the little dry, or the little pan that's here. Well, they're one of our bigger antelope species. Well, males can have some very impressive horns. I'm just going to go forward a little bit. See if we can spot the male. And then we'll go back to check on those impala. I'm hoping they'll have moved into a slightly more open area. Where did that male go? There he is. So that's the boy. You can see he's got big horns to fight the other boys for girlfriends. And all the waterbuck have that white ring around their bottom. Now, it's a following mechanism, so they can follow each other through the thick bush. Hello, Caden. Caden would like to know why they're called waterbuck. Well, Caden, in certain areas, when they are chased by lions or hyenas or leopards, they run into the water. And that's where they escape from their predators. Now, there's a wonderful... Oh, I'll have to tell you that story a little bit later. I'm going to try find that those impala again. While we do that, let's go back to James.
We've snuck just slightly closer, everyone, to the Wahlberg's eagle. We've come about, about 30 feet closer, maybe even more, 40 feet or so. And we're just trying to see if he will fly away, if he'll let us come towards him. Isn't this wonderful? He's such a beautiful bird, and I've never been this close to a bird like this on foot. Not ever, except once, actually. I'm talking nonsense. I have once, but that was a chick, and that was round about this time of the year when a couple of Wahlberg's eagles where I used to work, they lost their baby. He fell out of the nest and they left him, and he wasn't much smaller than this one. And so we picked him up, we took him home and we fed him, and he eventually flew off, and I don't know where he is now, but I think he survived. It's very special, and you can hear still maybe the Franklins going, butter, butter, butter. Josie, you're wondering if all eagles eat lizards. Josie, not all eagles will choose to eat lizards, but I suspect most eagles will if they have to eat lizards. Our biggest eagle, the Marshall Eagle, loves to eat lizards. But enormous lizards, big monitor lizards, they catch them quite a lot. I think you'll find that most eagles, if they find a lizard to eat, will eat a lizard. But they don't all specialize in them. So, for example, like I said, the African harrier hawk, at least the African hawk eagle, that loves to eat other birds. The Marshall Eagle will eat lizards, definitely. The Tawny Eagle and the Batalier Eagle, well, they like to eat carrion or rotting flesh. So they're a bit like vultures or what you would call a buzzard. They like to go down towards something that's dead and eat that. Ooh, there's something extra special going on now. Did you see the bird land on top there? Okay, we're not going to try and look at it now, but a very special bird called a great spotted cuckoo has just landed in the tree above our very friendly eagle. Now, come with us, everybody. I want you to be very, very, very quiet, okay? And I want you to watch where you place your feet. Be careful not to snap on any twigs or any leaves. We're going to go just a little bit closer to Mr. or Mrs. Wahlberg. I don't know if this is the male or the female. You know, with these birds, often the female is bigger than the male, unlike with human beings. Now, Aidan, you're wondering if... Oh, look, 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 there's the other one. Ashvanilish. Shafan. There was another big raptor, a big bird of prey that flew out of this tree.
Excuse me, everybody.
It flew out of the tree and away, but it's not a Wahlberg's eagle that flew out of the tree. Now, sorry, I missed that question. Oh, yes, you're wondering if we'll be attacked by it. I think it's Aidan. Aidan, we won't be attacked by this eagle. What he will do is fly away from us. He would never try and attack us because it's much easier for him to fly away than fly towards us. And most animals, if they attack a human being, it's because they're scared of us. It's not because they don't like us or because they want to eat us or hurt us. It's because they're afraid. And if you know that, you realize, of course, that an animal will run away from you, will fly away long before it decides to attack you. And so it's much easier for this eagle, which is smaller than us, to just fly away rather than try and attack us. It might attack us if we were trying to steal eggs from a nest, or if we were trying to perhaps take its chick out of a nest, then it might attack us. But as it stands now, it's not going to, I don't think. If it does, we'll make sure to film it. Hello, Logan. You're wondering how an eagle attracts a mate. Well, what they do, Logan, the first thing they have to do is have a shower, and then they put on their best feathers. And once they've put on their best feathers, they put on some nice smelling scent. Normally they pick it from a flower here called osimum, and it smells like aniseed. And then they go round to the nest of the eagle that they like, and they knock on one of the branches, and then the big daddy eagle sticks his head out of the nest and he says, "What do you want?" And out pops the big daddy eagle's daughter. And he says, "I'd like to take your daughter out to see a movie, please, sir." And off they go on a date, and if they like each other, well, then they spend the rest of their lives together. They get married. Logan, I'm obviously talking absolute nonsense. They do it through probably pheromones, you know. Pheromones are a very special kind of chemical that all bodies produce. We do as well. And it's what attracts male and female animals to each other. And if they smell right to each other, so if a male Wahlberg's eagle smells right to a female, and I'm not joking about this is absolutely true, and a female smells right to the male, then they will get together, and you know, with a Wahlberg's eagle, they mate for life. They'll form a pair bond, what we call a monogamous pair bond, and they come back to the same nest every year. So they make a home here in one of these trees. And every year they come back and they make a few modifications. They lay an egg and they raise a chick. And then they go back to North Africa for the winter. Doesn't that sound like a nice life? It means, everybody, you all... Remember, we chatted about migration very early on in this drive. And we spoke about the migrating monarch butterflies. Now, if you're a bird and you can migrate, what it means is you never have to have winter. Doesn't that sound fun? You're always in summer. So they come here for the summer, and then they go into the northern hemisphere while we have winter and the northern hemisphere has summer. All righty. I'm not sure that we're going to get any closer than this, but you know what? We're going to try. And while we're trying, let's go and find out how Brent's doing with his waterbuck.
So we're still with those waterbuck. Now, I tell you an interesting old African folklore about waterbuck. They are, and why they can go into the water, because of course in the water out here, there are crocodiles. But a waterbuck will run into the water even though there are crocodiles. And why would the crocodiles let the waterbuck do it? So the old story goes that many, many years ago, a crocodile was feeding along, or was sleeping on the edge of his river, and a big tree fell down and trapped the crocodile. And
the log, and Waterbuck happened to be walking past. Actually, I'm going to move a little bit further forward so you can see the mail. There we go, because that's important for the story. And Waterbuck happened to be walking past, and Crocodile said, "Oh, Waterbuck, Waterbuck, please help me with those beautiful big horns of yours and move the log off my back, so otherwise I'm going to die." Waterbuck said, "Not a chance, you scaly fiend. If I move that log off there, you'll just eat me next time I go into the water." And the crocodile begged and begged and begged and promised that Waterbuck would never be harmed if he ran into the water, and his whole family would be spared. And eventually, after much convincing, the Waterbuck used his big horns and lifted the log off the crocodile, and the crocodile was free. And since that day, Waterbuck has been free to take refuge from lions and other predators in the rivers and lakes of Africa. Of course, that is not a true story. A crocodile will eat a waterbuck given the opportunity, but it is an old African folklore from the Zulu people. Well, it's been absolute blast having... Wait, now I'm going to confuse you. It's Glen Oak and Glen Windsor. No! Creeds, Windsor Woods and Windsor Oaks. It's been great having you guys on Drive with us, and hopefully we'll be seeing you on another wonderful school trip soon. And we're going to jump across to Jamie, who's got another antelope.
And what a lovely start we have had to this sunset safari, and again a very warm welcome to all of our regular viewers and any of our new viewers. We've now said goodbye to our school and it's back to the normal sunset safari. The reason I'm whispering, there's a female walking past here. I think there is, I'm not sure, let me just go forward a little bit, she's moving off now. There's a female impala that was originally on her own, now she's been joined by another female and a little one. But there's a female impala that looks, she was on her own earlier, she might have just been separated from the rest of the group. She's that one on the right, Dave, I don't want to get too much closer. And she's waddling. Now, of course, she could just be waddling because she's heavily pregnant and that's the way that things go. But I've noticed her standing in a very uncomfortable looking position. She is panting as well, which could also be because it's hot. Yeah, little one. I did start to wonder whether or not she was going into labor, which is entirely possible. Most of the impala births take place in the morning. She just looks uncomfortable. Maybe she has an injury, maybe she hurt her leg whilst running, but she just looked a little bit unsteady on her feet. She was standing separate from the rest of the herd when I first found her, and she was sort of panting and looking particularly uncomfortable. So it could be, who knows, you never know when the animals... We've had a few live births before. I hear that Brent has got another female antelope in a very similar condition. I'm just wondering whether it's not worth not following her, because now that we're in this dense vegetation, there's no way that we can. But there is a road that cuts through just around there, and I think I'm going to go and have a look around there. Can you imagine a live antelope birth? How would that be, Dave, for your first afternoon back? Perfect, I agree. To celebrate the rest of our team, or almost the rest of our team, shame apart from Taylor, who missed her flight, almost the rest of the team's return. Let's just go around here, and then we should actually have a nice, very open view, because from this road we can see all the way to the DRC. We should have a very nice open view of her from far away, so she doesn't feel uncomfortable, and then we can decide as to whether or not it might be worth sticking around for a few minutes, just to see. She might also just be constipated. She's very pregnant. It's very hot. Their diets have changed over the last few days or last few weeks because of the rains. Whoopsies. We nearly missed the opportunity. And now, of course, I've lost track as to which one she was. Now there's two. I think that's her. I think that is her walking at the back. See that wide-legged stance? I don't see any sign of wetness, so water hasn't broken. But I have to confess, I also thought, mind you, that I saw some muscle contractions, but that could also have been the fetus kicking inside of her. So I'm not 100% sure. Hey, girl. She is looking very big. It's interesting that both of those impala look pregnant, and yet there is a little one with them. Not sure whether that baby's become confused or if maybe I'm just mistaken about the one female, but they both look pregnant to me. And perhaps there is another female that I just haven't seen. Okay, let's cut through this road here. See if we catch up with them there. They might be going to Gallego Waterhole for a drink. And welcome to Graham on our sunset safari. He wants to know if impala give birth to one lamb or if they can give birth to two. You'll probably find that there'll be exceptional cases of twins being recorded. I've never ever seen it. And I think that often people think that there are twins because they're seeing a sort of a group of lambs together, because lambs don't always, even from very early on, unfortunately, these lambs are all hiding behind the bushes. From very early on, the lambs tend to congregate in a group and often get separated from their mothers, and they tend to hang around with another female. But for the most part, it is very, very rare. I've never heard of it, but I wouldn't be surprised if there are recorded cases of twins being born. I'm not sure whether any of you have ever encountered a story of twin impala lambs, but they... All of the births and all of the babies that I have seen have just been one baby per impala. And that makes sense, because what it means is that the impala ewe can actually devote, and you'll find this with all of our herbivores, an impala ewe and a wildebeest cow and an elephant cow, they devote a huge amount of their body's resources into making these little babies, which is why twin antelope and twin herbivores are exceptionally rare. They are born so precocial, so well developed, that it makes sense for the females to put more of their resources and of course have more space for a developing baby, so that they can produce the biggest babies possible. And impala lambs are pretty large when you think about it. They look tiny now, but when you compare them to the size of their moms, their legs almost seem as long as their mothers, which is very important for their survival. And exactly the same thing applies for a wildebeest or an elephant or a buffalo. It makes more sense to invest your resources into only producing one baby that is able to get up and ready and run. Whereas with the carnivores, it's the complete opposite, because they can actually hide their babies away. They're better at hiding their babies away. They've got a completely different approach to raising little ones, which means that their gestation periods are shorter, which again is important, because when you're pregnant, hunting is a huge, it takes a huge toll on your body, and it's also very dangerous for the predators. It takes one kick to the stomach to really jeopardize a pregnancy. So as a result, they keep the pregnancies as short as they possibly can. For all of our big cats, they sit at around 90 to 100 days, and their babies are born much, much smaller in proportion to the adults, and they take longer to grow. They take a lot longer to grow up. They're born altricial. In other words, they are not able to run and to exist in the same way that these baby impala are. There are recorded cases, of course, of elephant twins, and there are also rare instances of giraffe twins as well. Although, again, it's another situation where I think that a lot of the time people have assumed a giraffe has had twins, when in fact it is just another baby giraffe and the mother's out of sight. And a little one resting there. Now, I'm sorry to leave these impala, but I just want to see if we can catch up with that female. It might just be that she's feeling hot, muggy, tired, pregnant. Her ankles are probably a bit swollen. She's probably had to urinate 5 times in the last hour. So, I mean, it could just be that she's feeling hugely uncomfortable. There we go, there they're coming through. Now, Holly, you want to know whether or not impala will allosuckle. So if, for example, a little baby impala gets separated from the rest of the herd, will another mother nurse it? No, they don't. And they actually, oh dearie me, I've lost track of which female it was now. There's so many impala here. Holly, no, they won't. And they're actually quite actively aggressive in pushing a baby away that is not theirs. There's a very, very strong bond between the mothers and their offspring. And you'll see it with everything from wildebeest. I mean, I have seen zebra foals being kicked and bitten by females that won't help them out. I can understand impala would be a slightly different thing, but no, they'll headbutt the babies and they'll push them away from their teats. And of course, many of you, I think quite a few of you will perhaps have had some farm experience or perhaps have been on farms before, and you'll know that with female sheep, if you do want to get the mother to accept a lamb that isn't hers, you have to go about doing so in a very, very careful way. And a lot of that is purely scent-based, which obviously doesn't happen in the wild. The mother bonds so tightly to the sound and to the smell of her own baby that she won't accept another one. Oh dear, I have lost track of our female. I have absolutely no idea which one it was that we were looking at. It could be any one of the back here. And actually, if she was going into labor, she probably would not have rejoined the rest of the herd. So perhaps we got a little bit overexcited there. But I'm sure you are all wondering what's happening with Brent. And I'm sure I think it's time to head over to him so that he can update you.
Look at that. It's a very tatty-looking joker. Oh, it looks like she's missing a bit of her wings. But feeding on a lovely, lovely little weeping wattle flower. It looks like that joker made a narrow escape from some predatory bird or possibly other insect. Ooh. And I hear something else that flies, but a bit bigger than a butterfly. No, I heard him calling, I'm going to go backwards. So I heard that, whoop, the beginning of the black-bellied bustard's call. Ah, there we go, got it. Top of the termite mound. Just trying to get a good spot. Strange. There we go. How's that, Chandra? Bit more? So there we go. A male black-bellied bustard sitting on a nice prominent termite mound. Now, they'll call and display from a high ground like that to try attract all the ladies. Now, let's see if it does that wonderful popping sound. There we go. There we go, there's the pop. Oh, I do love watching them when they call. Come on, girls, where are you? He almost looks to the sky, saying, ladies, why do you abandon me? Off he goes. He's coming down the termite mound. No ladies responding to his precious calls from the top. So he's probably going to move through here. He might be a bit hungry. He also might just move to another vantage point, another piece of higher ground, where he can possibly attract the attention of some females. Bye-bye, mister. Oh, lovely.
Now, this hot weather has most of the animals hiding. Unfortunately, those two pregnant impala we're following went down into the thickets where we can't get a car, and if they are going to give birth, I don't want to disturb them. But quickly across to Jamie with another feathered friend.
A feathered friend that is actually very often quite shy, which is why we've stopped to listen to it. It's also making a racket this afternoon. So let me just be quiet for a second so that you can hear the sounds it's making. It is a brown-headed parrot, and you can just see it cheeping. I know that the black-headed oriole, that whistle, is sort of the overwhelming sound that we're hearing. But you're listening to the whistling. Can you hear it there, Dave? Perfect, thank you. The brown-headed parrot. And the black-headed oriole, not to be outdone, is making an absolute racket next to me. And I can't even put it on camera for you, because every time we try to, it flies away. But since the light is very difficult and there's absolutely nothing that Dave can do about that situation, I thought for our new viewers, we'd just show you exactly what it looks like in the book. So this is our brown-headed parrot. It is, in fact, the only parrot that we really will see here. And obviously it gets its name from the brown head. And sometimes the names of birds out here are not all that imaginative. Here he is with his hooked fruit-eating bill, looking very much like the parrots that many of you will know and love from various, if you've had parrots as pets, which of course is something that is, I always find is a very difficult one. Birds in cages often upset me a great deal. This is a brown-headed parrot. We could also potentially, maybe, see a Mayer's parrot. Now, a Mayer's parrot you'd only really find right up in the top north. Oh, sorry, Dave. Let me take my thumb away from the Rupel's parrot, because if you're seeing a Rupel's parrot, you're definitely in the wrong place. Sorry, no, that was totally my fault. The Mayer's parrot is a completely brown one with a bright yellow spot on the top of its head. Now, you'd have to be right up in the top northwestern parts of Kruger to see one of these, if you're lucky. But some of you, those of you who perhaps have traveled South Africa and traveled Kruger, might have seen this particular bird as well. Of course, whenever I sit with my bird book, who have just commented on the name of the bird, I often like to read out the voice, the literal reading of bird calls as written by ornithologists. Unfortunately, that one's quite boring. Typically parrot-like, raucous shriek. Oh, that's disappointing, isn't it, Dave? That is most disappointing. You could also see a grey-headed parrot, but again, we're quite far outside of their range. A grey-headed parrot looks exactly like that one that was sitting up at the top of the tree, chattering away, but it, of course, has a grey head, not a brown head. Who on earth would ever have guessed? And since this oriole is being so demanding and sitting so beautifully where Dave can't see it, I'm going to try and find it for you. I can hear you whistling. The bird that, of course, we always think about, or when we think about Sam and his favorite bird. Now, the light isn't spectacular for it. Can you see it there, Dave? Yeah. Oh, you horrible bird. You horrible creature. The joys of live wildlife filming, particularly when your subjects have wings. And I seem to be really testing Dave on his first day back from leave. I'm sorry, Dave. I'm sorry. We'll go find a giant land snail. No, Dave's doing a marvelous job. Only playing with him. All right, birds. Let's go find a different black-headed oriole, because that one was just taunting us. He was just waiting for us to turn the camera onto it before it flew away. That is, of course, half the fun. It wouldn't be nearly as much fun if it was easy, would it, Dave? Exactly. All of our cats have abandoned us. The lions have gone into Simbambili. Karula's gone into Little Gowrie. Tingana's gone into Torchwood. So our leopards are off property. Our lions are off property. They're all around, though. And, of course, with Karula, particularly the queen of Juma, that female leopard, she has a way of doing unexpected returns, or making unexpected returns. Lavnisha, you wanted to know about the two cubs that went with the Lion Pride. Lavnisha, we haven't heard anything, but I am planning a trip across in that direction in the not-too-distant future, so I will try and find out from some of the other guides and I'll let you know. So what Lavnisha means, and for those of you that perhaps missed yesterday's safari, we were with all six cubs with the females at a buffalo kill at City Dam. And after we left to make vehicles, apparently James was there and... further into the dip. Got out to drive. Let's go up this hill. Here we go. There we go. So what happened there was the anti-poaching patrol, from what we can tell, doing their regular patrol, the lions saw them on foot and they ran away, and two of the cubs remained behind. Now I'm going across to Sydney's Dam to see what's happened with that buffalo carcass. I imagine with its proximity to our hyena clan, and that side of the... Sorry, it's another parrot. And just flew away again. With their proximity to the hyena clan, I think that buffalo is going to be gone, but we will check up and see. I have a lot of faith that those cubs will be reunited with the pride. I have a feeling after all of the Nkuhumas, everything that they've gone through and that incredible ability of those little cubs to survive a huge amount, I think they're going to be fine. But I will try and double check for you and let you know. Our James seems to have a unique knack for approaching animals on foot. I think we should go and see what he's found this time.
I'm not so sure about that unique knack doing anything on foot, frankly. But anyway, we've got lucky here with some waterbuck cows who are fascinated by Brian. Aren't they, Brian?
They are.
They are totally fascinated by him. What's interesting here is that they're different colours. The one on the left is, well, drabish grey-brown. The one on the right has got a very pretty blonde mane, if that's your sort of thing. And then the one on the right is kind of, in between. And that's interesting because often, I think, you know, you see a waterbuck and you think, well, but like impala, they're exactly the same as each other. And very clearly they are not. There might be an age difference there. It might just be that they sometimes have different coloured hair, a bit like us. Now they've taken fright, of course, because I was commenting on the way they look. They're very shy, you see. I shouldn't have done that, should I, Brian?
No.
It was objectifying them to some degree.
Yeah.
On we go. I'm not sure what our signal is going to be like. We're going to head off along the road through here. I said on the road and then through here because I was given a sharp instruction through the medium of a pointing fist by Herbert, who said, no, through here. So we're going down through here towards a waterhole, a little waterhole called Chatter, and we're hoping there might be something there. We might also be slowly, and if we look like we're going to lose you, we'll quickly stop and find something to show you. In fact, I may have found something already. This is interesting. I think it's been eaten out. This is the ball of a dung beetle. But it's old and it's been buried and I think it's been dug up. Let me open it up. Yeah, it's been eaten out. I think you'll find that a dung beetle may well have hatched out of that. So maybe the grub ate its dung, pupated, and became a dung beetle, and is now flying around looking for dung. And this, over here, I stand to correction, is where I think it could well have come from. Can you see this? I think this was dung. This was buffalo dung. It was a pile of buffalo dung. And the dung beetles have come and they've buried it completely. They've broken it up, and they've buried it under the ground. I'm just going to gently move it away. What I don't want to do is expose any egg, because they don't all roll balls, of course. Lots of the dung beetles just lay their egg underneath the dung. But I think that's what's going on here. Anyway, I don't want to disturb it. It would be tragedy not to have as many dung beetles as possible. Of course, we love our dung beetles, don't we, Brian?
We do.
Yes, we do. On we go. Come on now. It's not a very good dung beetle day, really, because, of course, there is cloud. They don't seem to like the cloud very much. And as many of you will know, I've been reading that book on quantum biology, which is it's not a light read. It's not something you read, without your brain in full function, really. And one of the fascinating things, of course, is that a lot of birds navigate, we think, using basically a quantum computer, which is something that we as humans have completely failed to design. And what I think is happening with dung beetle, I suspect you'll find there's an element of that in the way that they navigate and find their way to dung. Pihart? I'm going to have to ask for that question again. Oh, if a dung wool gets wet, can it be reused again? You mean by dung beetles, Pihart? I don't think so, no, because I think a lot of what the dung beetles like is the moisture. There's probably quite a lot of nutrition in the moisture in dung. It's not just water, so I wouldn't think so, no. Now, is this what I think it is, or is it just a piece of bird dung? Herbie? Scale insect? Or is that bird poo? It is, in fact, bird poo, according to Herbert. He says this is not a scale insect. It is a piece of bird poo. How fascinating and wonderful. How embarrassing at the same time. Now, well, I will just tell you something about this bird poo, and that is that, of course, the white bit there is uric acid. And birds and reptiles are unable to urinate and defecate separately. So they must do it out of the same opening. That's called the cloaca, and that's why we find you urinating and defecating at the same time, and that's basically hardened urine on the top. How fascinating.
Wonderful.
Yes. Not a scale insect, but a piece of bird turd. On that note, let's get across to Jamie Patterson, who is more polite than I, and will find you something a lot more delightful than the turd of a bird.
No, I have a history with finding with finding other such defecations of animals. I was going to go to Sydney's Dam until I remembered, unfortunately, that Jigger can't go to Sydney's Dam. She doesn't have signal there. But I promise I will try and find what's happening with those lions, and I will get back to you if we have any answer on that. I'm sure they're going to be absolutely fine. I'm sure those cubs will be reunited with their mums once again, and we will once again be six cubs strong. But for now, we just don't know. I found you something that is not a bird or a defecation. It is, in fact, a steenbok. And if I go backwards, can you see it there, Dave? It's peering at you. There we go. Hello, little girl. A fully grown female steenbok, and she's slightly smaller than the baby impala that we've spent our afternoon looking at. It's slightly bulkier, but definitely slightly shorter. She's roughly the size of a, what's a good breed of dog to compare her to? Something small and light. Goodness, I can't think now. I had a breed in my head. Yes, that's perfect, like a spaniel. She's like a little cocker spaniel. Bye-bye. And that, of course, is our typical view of steenbok dashing off. She's probably just stopped behind that termite mound. They tend not to go all that far, and they just go to a hiding place where they feel slightly more safe, and that's that. So I doubt she's gone all that far. And since we can't go to Sydney's Dam, I think we'll go to Biffleshook Dam instead. Go and check out the water holes. It's hot this afternoon. It's quite an oppressive heat, so hopefully something's come down to drink. And maybe even, perhaps I spoke about Karula coming back, maybe even Tingana will decide to grace us with his presence. I'm sure Brent filled you in on the fact that he walked over our vehicle tracks this morning. Ah, Virginia, you would like to go on a pangolin search. I have to tell you, Virginia, that every drive is a pangolin search from our perspective. Luckily, I have Dave, the great pangolin spotter, who has spotted more pangolin than any of us on these live drives, and that's because he saw one. The only one, the one and only. Well done, Dave. He wasn't quite sure what it was. But other than that, he is the greatest pangolin spotter we have, statistically. Statistically, of the pangolins we have seen, Dave has spotted all of them. You'll take it. So yes, Virginia, always a pangolin search. A pangolin, for our new viewers who are wondering what on earth a pangolin is, it's probably the rarest mammal species you could see on these drives. They are the most shy, the most secretive. As far as I know, Brent's pangolin that he found with Dave, that Dave found on the Kruger boundary, was the first one, I think, that had ever been seen on the live drives. I might be wrong, certainly the first one in the last 2 and a bit years. So, yes, we are always searching for pangolin. The biggest problem with seeing pangolin on a day like today is it's very hot. Winter is usually your best time for our secretive nocturnal animals. A pangolin is a walking artichoke-like animal, or a spiny anteater is perhaps a better way of describing it, rather than a walking artichoke. They have scales, they are nocturnal, and they are anteaters, and they are about yay big. Couple of kilograms, hefty little animal, lovely looking creatures that curl up into a ball when they're threatened. It is a little bit hot. Your best time of year for seeing pangolins during the day is winter. But animals and rule books, we know all about that, don't we? Never say, never ever say never. I'm trying to gauge if that woodlands is going to be worth it. And you see it hopping around. Sorry, Dave. If we look at the big tree with the leaves, the other big tree. Oh, okay, that'll do. That'll definitely do. I'll go with that. What on earth have we got here? This is interesting. Well done, Dave. That's definitely not a woodland kingfisher, but it is a very large bird of prey. And I wonder perhaps if it's not that very large bird of prey we saw earlier. It is a very warm bird of prey as well. I'm just looking at the wings and the way that they cross, the very, very long wings that seem to cross at the back. Just a slight crest to it. I'm not 100% sure. I want to get a bit closer would be ideal. How am I going to do that? Where's my nearest road? Let's try and sneak up on that. Let's try and get a little bit closer, figure out exactly what it is. Unfortunately, my binoculars are irreparable. I'm going to have to buy a new pair of binoculars, but I'm going to have to go all the way around and onto the fire break to get a closer view. So we've all just got to hope that this particular bird decides to hang around. Please hang around, bird. Well spotted, Dave. That is most dev. I can tell you what it's not. It's not a woodland kingfisher. That it is most definitely not. My bird IDing skills are on fire this afternoon. I did see a little bit earlier, I had to rush back briefly to the main camp that we all live in and work out of. I had to rush back to the main camp to just do a little bit of work on the vehicle. And I thought I saw a juvenile martial eagle. That one, to me, though, doesn't look big enough to be a juvenile marshal. And I know that James also saw a mystery bird this morning. He said juvenile step eagle. Now let's go and see. Those long, long wings at the back, it's making me think step. But I couldn't see the eye and the face clearly enough. And with the wind blowing like that, it sort of created this impression of a crest that I think might be, might be a false impression. Okay, now we've got to hope in our long journey that our bird has decided to stick around. Luckily, the team at Juma have fixed up this road beautifully. Now, Brandon, you reckon that it is an African hawk eagle. It's possible. I don't think so, though. I think it's too big. I have to confess, just being able to see perspective, it could well be there is a pair of African hawk eagles. Sorry, everybody. Let's bump our way through this. There is a pair of African hawk eagles that live here. I don't think it's an African hawk eagle, but it's possible that you are correct. I think it's a little bit too big, though. Oh, goodness. Bird book flying everywhere, somewhat ironically. My bottle of water's tumbling about. There we go. All right. Now we've got to seriously hope that it hasn't decided to fly away. And that I can remember where it was. I think we were just past this crest. That's where the woodland was. That's the tree that the woodland kingfisher was in that turned into an eagle. There it is. Okay, let's try and get a view of it from a different angle. The other thing that makes me think not, but perhaps I was mistaken in my glimpse, was that its boots or its feathered legs looked very dark to me. Okay, let me take my foot off the brake so that we don't... Well done, Dave. Ooh, it could be with that light under the wings. It's too big. It is slightly too big for an African hawk eagle. Excuse me, would you be so kind as to turn around? Dark eye, but I mean that doesn't really help us in terms of the various eagles. Most of them have dark eyes. It's definitely an eagle, obviously, just given the size, the shape of the bill, the shape of the body, and the legs. Kim, you say Wahlbergs. Again, it's a little bit big for a Wahlbergs. It's actually got a yellow... It does that have a yellowish eye? Because that would be hugely helpful. It does, doesn't it? I'm not mistaken. I mean, I'm busy looking through my monitor, but it does look like it is slightly yellow. You got that bit of extra zoom. Oh, yes, of course. Dave can actually zoom in a little more. Very dark in colour. I want to see your front. It would be most useful if I could see your front. If you would be so kind as to turn around. There's one other thing that I'm thinking, but I just want to check before I say it. I was thinking about a lesser spotted. It's a bit dark. And perhaps doesn't have enough on the wings, not enough white on the wings. I have this funny feeling I'm being very silly. And I'm not quite sure why I've got this funny feeling that I'm being very silly. There's something so familiar about this particular eagle. I can tell you that with that face, it's definitely not an African hawk eagle. So, Julia, you said the juvenile marshal. That's what I was thinking. That was my first thought, and then I said I wasn't sure it was big enough, but I thought I'd seen one earlier. Dave, I think this is the same bird we nearly stopped for earlier. It's actually, now that I think about it, it's directly in the line that we were in from before. A juvenile marshal, the funny thing about juveniles is they can always be a little bit tricky. That's what I was thinking with the size, that it's too big for almost anything else but a marshal. So there we go. Julia, I think I'm on the same page as you. I think it is a juvenile marshal, and I think that crest with the wind blowing it up is what we are looking at. But where? I'm just trying to find it in my book so I can show you. Juvenile marshals have a great deal of white on them. But it would be wonderful if it was a juvenile martial eagle. I have not seen one of those in quite a while. Isn't it beautiful? I think it's a juvenile on its way to getting the adult martial eagle's plumage. I think that's exactly what it is. And I think it's the same bird that Dave and myself stopped for earlier. And remember, I straight away said a juvenile martial eagle. Now I've overthought everything. But it is, it's a juvenile martial. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. The problem is... Good. So Brent is on the same, I'm not quite sure how, but Brent is agreeing with us. Brent agrees it is a juvenile martial. I'm impressed. It just hasn't quite got to the point that it's got that darkness. I mean, that it's in between. So if we look at our juvenile martial here, here's our juvenile martial. Very, very light in color. So it's a very light-colored bird. However, there, of course, is the adult plumage, and I think our one is coming in between here. And did have a very, very short gape here. So the sort of the distance that the bill extends, and the adults do have yellowish eyes. And I think that this is a juvenile martial that is well on its way to getting its adult's plumage. Now there we go. We have our answer. And well done for Julia for sending that through. It is a juvenile martial eagle. How lovely. That is a relatively unusual sight. I can tell you what is not an unusual sight is the sight of James lying on the ground. Let's go and see what he's up to.
I'm attempting the posture of Cleopatra. How am I doing, Brian?
Great. The camera loves you.
Do I look like Cleopatra?
Exactly.
After some Botox. That's not why I'm lying on the ground, everybody. That was just an aside. We've been sitting here for a little while, and of course Brian and I became bored. Now, what we have here is something actually very interesting. This is the mountain of a steenbok. Now, a steenbok, as many of you will know, is a territorial little antelope, the smallest antelope that we get. But what's interesting here is that he's buried his dung. Now, I read about this, and you read that they bury their dung in order that they are not obvious to predators. This guy's done a particularly poor job of it. But they only do it in the middle of their territories. On the outside of the territory, they don't bury the dung like this. They leave it out so that other steenbok know that this is where they live. But inside the territory, they bury it over like this. So he's come and he's kicked. You can see we're pointing with the grass now. He's kicked there, dug up the soil, pushed it over the dung, not done a very good job of it. This happened right now, and in fact we saw a steenbok running away from the spot just as we came up towards it. So I think that's rather interesting, don't you? And it smells, well, it smells like goat dung, basically. Brandon, you've asked a very good question, and it's one we discuss quite often, and one that I'm not entirely sure. Ah! It's a thorn in my bottom, Brian. I'm going to stand up now. We're okay now. Right, why a steenbok alone? It's a very, very good question, and it's an interesting one. It is because they want to remain hidden. Now, that might seem obvious, but it isn't really, because why wouldn't an impala want to remain hidden? Why wouldn't a buffalo want to remain hidden? Why do they live in herds, and why does steenbok choose to live on their own? And the answer is because once you are above a certain size, say bushbuck sized, it is to your disadvantage to be in a group, because even though you might have extra vigilance, you're still too, it's still more effective to stay on your own. You are detected far less than you are able to see things. So to put it another way, if you're big like an impala is, the disadvantage of being more obvious to the predators is outweighed by the advantage of the greater vigilance. If you're very small like a steenbok, the disadvantage of being more obvious to predators if you're in a group is outweighed by the advantage of living on your own and being able to hide. Does that make sense? Every time I give that explanation, I have to think very carefully about which part is disadvantageous and which part is advantageous. And let me tell you, it's not easy with the thorn in your left buttock. Good. On we go. Lions calling. At this time of the day, long way away. Miles and miles away. I think probably, Chitwa, eh? Yeah, Herbert says, yeah, probably Chitwa, so quite a long way away from here. Anyway, that is the Steenbok, and we're going to proceed. We're going to proceed now and head a little bit further south, and then we're going to head west and head back north, back towards quarantine clearings. Af Hambeso. If I do develop a slight limp, everybody, it is, of course, because I was stabbed mercilessly. Ooh! No, I have not, Jackie J. You say, have I heard Herbert do the black-bellied buster call? We'll ask him now if he will do it. Herbert, would you be prepared to do the black-bellied buster call? Allow me to stand next to you so that you can hear it. Thank you, Jackie J. You just made my day. That is fantastic. Ah, good. All right. Brent Leo Smith is up and around. I'm not sure where he is or what he's found, but you can ask him while I collapse on the floor laughing at that wonderful rendition of the black-bellied bustard.
Well, we ventured off Juma onto Arethusa. So I'm going to do a quick check around this area. We did have shadow not too far away from here a few days ago, but in Juma. So I just want to check up towards Knobthorn open area, maybe down towards Red Dam, and maybe we will have some shadow luck. She has been quite elusive over the last while. Now, other than that, we have not seen much at all. I think 3 impala, 7 waterbuck, and a few birds. Now, Anita would like to know, where are the elephants? Well, Anita, what happens as soon as it rains, the elephants spread out. Oh, I just want to listen to this quickly. Sorry, Anita, but they've all spread quite far, quite wide, and into Kruger, maybe some down to the south, the Sand River. So sorry, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. So they're very well spread out, and they're quite highly mobile, and they'll be following where the different reins are. Afternoon stations, Brent crossing from the north. Any updates for the afternoon? Gabi, thanks very much. And we're going to go look for... We don't know yet, because there are no updates on Arethusa. We're going to keep moving. Hopefully we have a little luck on our side and we'll be able to find some fantastic creatures here on Arethusa. If not, we'll find some fantastic plants. Now, I haven't been to this area around Knobthorn Open for quite some time. I was hoping maybe there's some wildebeest here today, but it's not looking like it. Not even a lone bull so far. So there we go, here's Knobthorn Open area. Hi, Harry. Harry would like to know how I came to have this job. Well, Harry, it's a quite interesting story. So, I mean, I've worked and lived in the bush most of my life, and I just finished a stint in Gabon in Central Africa, and I came back to do private guiding again, and I was doing private safaris for different guests all over Africa. And I got a phone call from Monsieur Graham Wallington. And he was looking for guides who could possibly present as well. And I'd been recommended to by two different friends of mine who happened to also be friends of his. And I came on an interview. I said three bad words in one interview, naughty Brent, but I managed, I'm still here. And that's sort of how it happened. So the sort of private guiding went to the back seat, and now nearly 2 years down the road, we're driving around live in the African bush. And it looks like Arethusa is having a bush dinner tonight. And I can tell that by when you find a great host of chairs out in the middle of the bush. So what will happen probably, what's the time? Yes, in the next half an hour or so, the chefs will descend, start the fire, set the table, and everyone will get to enjoy a lovely dinner out in the bush. Now, for the guests staying at the lodge, it's normally a big secret. They don't know about it. So when they think, oh, it's time to go home, they drive through and there'll be lanterns and whatnot spread through all the bush, and it's generally quite beautiful. So because it's been so hot and sweaty today, I'm hoping that possibly some of those nomadic elephants Anita is wondering about might have made their way towards Red Dam. Or maybe Shadow decided she needs to quench her thirst. Hi Jane. Jane says, do I know where the woolly neck stork nest is located in Arethusa? She'd love to see it. I'm afraid I don't, to be honest. Well, hopefully it's around Red Dam, I think. Or have a look at some of the big trees there. Mulwanini. The Mulwanini is not Arethusa. The Marikeni. Yes. So apparently it's in the Marikeni drainage, and at the moment I'm afraid it's one of those areas that's giving us a little bit of technical difficulty, so I would also love to go see it, but I don't think we're going to be able to today. So we're about to arrive at Red Dam. Let's see what's there. There's something dead around here. Very, very old dead. But while we make our way towards Red Dam, Jamie's got another feathered friend.
I have no doubt that what Brent is smelling is the recently deceased buffalo that the Nkuhuma female Amber Eyes and her Birmingham boy companion killed not too long ago but never actually ate. They left it next to Red Dam, so I'm sure Brent's going to find that. In the meantime, we are with one of our cuckoo species, and it is in fact the Levalence cuckoo, or used to be known as the striped cuckoo. It is now the Levalence cuckoo. And you'll notice that we always say the old names, partly because we always remember them by their old names, those of us that grew up birding, but also for our viewers that are familiar with the birds and have been, especially our South African and sort of Southern African viewers that have been familiar with the old names and are now wondering about it. So it is a striped cuckoo. It is now known as a Levalence cuckoo. Of course, there was a huge drive to standardize bird names throughout Africa, since they all have different names in different places. And so the striped cuckoo became the Levalence cuckoo. And the two black cuckoos that we get, the Jacobin and the Levalence, are very, very similar. And I'm multitasking here because I'm trying to find you the page of the bird, but apparently I can't count and talk at the same time. Here we go. There we go. So that was the Levalence cuckoo. But quite easy to tell the difference, and you can actually see why. Here's our Levalence here on the right. You can see why it's called the striped cuckoo, because it has, well, stripes, a streaked throat, as described by the book. That's the bird that we're looking at there, the striped cuckoo. And this is the Jacobin cuckoo. Now, one thing that Brent must do when he's talking about that woolly-necked stork nest on Arethusa. Now, I actually saw that nest. I hadn't realized that they were there not too long ago. And sorry, Dave, I'm going to send you back there, sorry. The reason I'm mentioning it is because there is a dark Jacobin living in that drainage line and around Red Dam. Now, we must ask Brent very nicely to please keep a very close eye out. If he hears a Jacobin calling, or if he sees any Jacobins around, there is a dark form of the Jacobin cuckoo. So it has whites on it, white on its wings and white on its tail, but it has a completely black chest. And when I saw it, I did a double take and completely missed the ability, or missed the opportunity to take a photograph. Fortunately, VM was on point, and he managed to record it. So at some point, now he's on leave, I've missed my opportunity, but at some point I need to get that footage from him, because that to me is quite a rare bird. I've never seen one before. Thank you, Dave. I've never seen a dark form Jacobin cuckoo up until then. I went bounced all excited to see friends of ours, Tristan and Ali, for those of you that are familiar with them, you will know of them. We went to go and see them. Sorry, my microphone is... I'm scared I'm going to break it and John Ray's going to shout at me. Anyway, I bounced off to them to visit, and I said, when last did you see a dark morph Jacobin? And Tristan said to me, yesterday. Sort of took the wind out of my sails quite spectacularly. Turns out it was the same one in the same place, so it did make me feel slightly better. But I was so very excited about this particular bird. We always love seeing colour morphs, and we love seeing birds that we haven't seen before. This morning, for example, Brent had a painted snipe at Buffleshoek Dam. Oh, and there are some red-chested swallows as well, but they never sit still. Let's just stop for a second. Buffleshoek Dam is always a fantastic birding dam. Well done, Dave. Welcome back. Red-chested swallow. Epic. Not an easy... Ah, tricked you there. It bluffed. It fainted flying straight and it did a quick curve. Now the swallows will be dipping down to catch insects that are on the surface of the water, also to have a drink. They won't ever land next to the water. What they might be doing, some of the swallow species, is actually landing and collecting mud to make their homes, and that's particularly for our lesser striped swallows. Right, let us go and see if we can see where this painted snipe is. I'm hoping it's still here. That would be very convenient. So, Dave, we're going to keep our eyes peeled. It was on the far side of the dam. I do enjoy Buffleshoek Dam. It's the only place I've seen a purple heron before. That was a while ago, though. Of course, there was the squacco heron with Byron at Juma Dam. But I fear my hopes and dreams have been dashed. I'm devastated. There is no painted snipe. Unless I'm completely bonkers. But I don't think I am. I don't think there is one here. Oh well, I think what we should do, since there is no painted snipe to keep us entertained, I think we should head over to James, who's got a close-up view of some ants.
Well, I don't have a close-up view of a painted snipe, everybody, but what we do have there is ants devouring the fruits of a plant called Scotia capitata, or the dwarf boerbeen. Boerbeen, of course, means farmer's bean, and they very closely related to Scotia brachypetella, which, of course, is the weeping boerbeen, which is that's why the plant gets its name. The weeping boerbeen, of course, weeps sap, and they used to use these parts of the plant for coffee. The Boers did, the farmers. Very poor coffee, I imagine it was, but I don't think the dwarf boerbeen's ever been used for the same thing. Those ants are absolutely devouring the fruits. That means that this flower, or the plant, must have flowered, I don't know, probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago. And then everything has been fertilized, and they've produced these rather gorgeous fruits. Now the plant, the ants, I can actually identify. This is our own friend, our old friend, Polyrhynchus. And Polyrhynchus, Brian, as we know, tastes like a...
Pancakes.
No. Not pancakes. They taste like lemon drops, everybody. They don't taste anything like pancakes at all. Thank you very much for that, Brian. Right, I was going to give you one, but I'm not anymore because clearly your mind is not on eating Polyrhynchus the lemon drop, and rather you want to eat pancakes. Okay, come on, let's get out of here. The bushwalk is heading now in a northerly direction. We were hoping to pick up tracks of Hosanna somewhere in this little drainage system here because we didn't think that he had crossed the boundary south with Karula and Hrongile this morning, and so we were hoping that maybe he had gone a-wandering up here, but we haven't as yet found any sign of him. So we have sort of changed direction now. Oh, wonderful! Another gorgeous question from the world's either best or worst Twitter handle, depending on your opinion. This, I must just stop and address you. Tormented Zombie Owl. Let's just take a moment to appreciate that. Good. Tormented Zombie Owl, you want to know why it is that I'm wearing a sock upon my person. Well, Tormented Zombie Owl, this sock has a very interesting story behind it. It was, in fact, given to me when I was the master of ceremonies at a wedding not too long ago, and its partner fell by the wayside. And so I thought, well, this is a very good sock to use for the purposes of an ash bag. Now, you can see the ash there coming out. You see it, Brian?
Mm.
And what that's doing is telling us which way the wind is blowing, Tormented Zombie Owl, and in this case, it's hardly blowing anywhere at all. So, it's only important, really, if we're tracking something like a rhino, or an elephant, or a buffalo, or a lion, or a leopard, or something like that, which would pick up our scent. So, if we were king, we'd check the wind every so often, and if it was blowing towards where we were going, we might, if we thought we were very close, change direction so that the wind didn't straight towards the animal. That's why we carry it. It's an extremely effective way of telling which way the wind's blowing, because our noses are massively insensitive. But you can see from the ash here which way your scent would blow. Right, Tormented Zombie Owl. Let's carry on. See, Brian, I'm a Tormented Zombie Owl. Right, before Brian and I go completely mad, go across to Brent and find out if he has found a tormented zombie owl.
We're in a rush! We're in a rush!
Copy, thanks, Andrew. I'd like to join you.
Sir!
I affirm I'm coming from Impala Plants.
I wonder what we're going to see. Chandra thinks it's wild dogs, but he's wrong. Oh, I would also be very happy if it was wild dogs, but it's not. It's something else entirely. A Yeti. No, the only Yeti on Safari Live is on the back of my vehicle, and its name is Chandra. My pleasure. Remember, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. If you have any musings, ponderings, or questions for any of us, we would love to hear from you. Also, don't forget to tell us where you're from. Let's see, let's find out how many countries are watching. And at the moment, let's see if we can figure out, see how many different countries are watching. Send the... what country you're watching from through to the hashtag Safari Live. Or pop an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Let us know what country you are watching from, which way is faster, which way is faster. We'll stick on the main road. Less turns. Straight line. Now, even though the cloud cover has come over, it is still very, very warm. And I'm hoping that it doesn't cool down quick enough for whatever we're rushing to move off. It is right on our southern boundary. James Dungan would like to know, is it Anderson male leopard or is it quarantine male leopard? It is neither. It is a dwarf mongoose. Yes, we are rushing to a dwarf mongoose. Near my cat, Illinois, would like to know, is it a pangolin? I wish so dearly it was a pangolin, but alas, it is not a pangolin. That is a car. We don't want to run into that. Hello, hello. Hi. Bye. Remember the bush dinner crew? There they go to set up a lovely dinner for the guests of Arethusa. Create some dust for us to chew on while we drive. Okay. We're going to try and get there as quick as possible. Hopefully this mysterious creature does not vanish. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's up to in the east.
Oh, I have to confess, I have absolutely no idea what Brent is rushing to. So it's going to be as much of a surprise for me as it is for all of you. I accidentally turned my game drive radio down and I forgot to turn it back up. I actually didn't realize I turned it down, so I didn't turn it back up. So I have no idea what he's rushing to, so I'm as excited as all of you. There's a part of me that's thinking about our cat streak and the fact that we didn't... that we didn't find a cat this morning. I'm sorry, I'm distracted now by the call of this Cokie Franklin. Where is it, though? It sounded close. Herbert once told us while we were on walk that the Franklins, you can set your watch by a Franklin call. What time is it now? 5:52. Not quite, Herbie. He said that they call every on the hour, and then at 5:15, and then at 5:30, every quarter of an hour. And then we'd keep hearing Franklin calls, and he'd go, there, you see. And it would be some random time, like 22 minutes to 5 or something. I have no idea where this Cokie Franklin is. It was chirping merrily away, but I can't see it. They usually call from the top of termite mounds, like the black-bellied bustard that Herbie was herbitating. It's a new word for imitating. Herbie was imitating a little bit earlier with James. I'm not sure what Herbie was herbitating means. That's a whole new description for what Herbie does. Look at this cornball having a dust bath. Having a marvelous time. Don't stop, please. I love watching them do this. It's always thoroughly entertaining. And they don't do it for very long, but they do coat themselves in sand and dust. Oh, and we're done. Hop, hop, skip and jump back to lunchtime. A red-billed hornbill. For those of you who are new to these safaris, one of the most common birds that we will see. Also one of the most entertaining. If you have the time to sit and look and watch what they get up to, I do wish you'd carry on dust bathing. What he was doing there was it seems like an oxymoron, I think, to say he's having a dust bath, as we tend to think of baths as a way of getting clean. And in his own way, that's exactly what he's doing. He's actually ridding himself of, or herself, I suppose, although it's most likely a he at this time of year, hopping around foraging. He could be looking for food for his nest mate. So what they're doing is they're using the grit, much like you would use an exfoliator in a way, to, and he's not aiming for dead skin cells, but he is using it as a way of scraping away mites, pepper ticks, parasites, fleas. Feathers can be a very dirty thing. So he's got to make sure that he keeps his in pristine condition. So by shaking the dirt over him, it will dislodge some of those parasites. And quite frankly, I actually think they just enjoy it. I think it feels good. Much like that. A jolly good scratch. Oh, nearly fell down there. Dave, remember our red-billed hornbill nest?
I do.
You remember that on Twin Dams? We never saw him again. I don't know. I mean, I have stopped there many, many times, but I think my timing's just been off, and he hasn't been around. I'm sure they're fine. As evening starts to descend, soon the birds will be going to bed and all of the other diurnal creatures will be heading for shelter. That includes our bushwalk team, who would like to share their final few minutes with you.
Now, we started this wonderful show, everybody, with that Wahlberg's eagle sitting very close to us, and we've come to the nest. And I'm just looking up there with my binoculars. And I don't think they have a youngster this year. I might be quite wrong. They just lay a little bit later than they do, than they would have otherwise. There doesn't seem to be much going on in that nest. It's the middle one, and then there's some red-billed buffalo weaver's nests on either side. We're just going to go around the tree quickly. The eagle did fly off. When it did eventually fly, it came back towards this area, so I'm sure it's around here somewhere. We have seen them in the nest, though. But normally by now you can see a little head peeping up over the top, if they had laid it when I thought they had. Because remember, they mated, when did they mate? At least 2 months ago. Anyway, that's going to be it for the bushwalk team today. We are going to head back, and Brent apparently has got a surprise for you. So we will see you tomorrow morning from the burnt piece of toast that has had a bit taken out of it. That's quite surprising itself. Let's head across to Brent Leo Smith and his surprise. Bye-bye.
And it is the little prince, the little chief, Hosanna. Hello, boyo. Looking hot, but fat. Now, Shongile and Karula were seen a little bit to the south, not far from here. So I think he's just wandering around chasing things like he does from time to time. They were all seen together this morning. Over. So there he is. You can see how heavily he's breathing from the heat. And he has also got quite a full belly. So he's by no means starving. And then you can see that little damp bit on his bottom jaw and on his top lip. He's been having a drink. Look how he's folding his ears as he comes up to the edge of the dam wall. And in case there's potential prey around. You spotted, he's having a look, seeing if there's any squirrels to chase. I know a lot of you have been quite worried that he's lost his mom for a little bit, but leopards at this age often lose their mothers. It's not uncommon at all, but they normally do find them again. And they're quite capable of catching enough to survive. Look how he's going into that hunting pose, ears flat. What has he spotted? Nothing, he just doesn't want to be spotted. Okay, we're going to move around to the other side of him. So we've got Netherlands, Sweden, France, Australia, South Africa, and of course the US. So it sounds like we've got someone from everywhere today. Yeah, we're just going to get ourselves into a good spot opposite him, and also so we can see what he might be seeing on the other side in case a poor unsuspecting impala wanders up. I forgot about that log. Ah, there we go. Over, done. Oh, Jean-André, did it nearly hit you? Ah, a little stick attacked Jean-André. Okay, now Shongile was seen probably about 400 or 500 meters from here, just to the south of us, outside of our traverse zone. But Mr. Hassane is on the move. Nice and warm. I'm surprised he's sitting on the damn wall like that, and it's probably still going to be still quite hot. Now Alice in Ohio, hi Alice. Alice would like to know, do I think is his nose turning darker? Not particularly darker than it was when I saw him last, which was 2 days ago. But it will get darker as he gets older. Also, I think his nose might look a little bit darker because he might have popped it in the water while he was having a drink a little bit earlier. He's getting very big very quickly. Still not quite the same size as Karula just yet. Yes, his nose looks like it's got a bit of mud on it. You're putting your nose in the mud, you silly boy. He's tired now. It's tough chasing squirrels and dwarf mongooses and Franklins. Hi Steph, who's in Belgium, he's another country. Steph would like to know, is the heavy breathing cooling him down? It'll help, Steph. So the panting is how most of the big cats will cool themselves. But the ground is so hot, he's getting up and moving constantly. So what happens is he's got lots of blood vessels in his mouth, and particularly in his tongue. So what he does is the faster he breathes over it, the quicker it will transport that cooled blood around his body. Now, I said this is quite a strange place for him to lie, specifically since, well, the sun's not out, but this hard damn wall would have definitely retained quite a lot of heat from the beating sun of today. The reason we rushed here so quickly is because Karula is still in the south, so he might quite easily pop back down to the south quickly. So that's why we had to speed to get here. And it seems like we got here in time for him to take a little rest. He is going to grow into quite a big male leopard, I think. And he's filling out quite nicely at the moment.
So Ephraim's just arrived. I was just waving hello. Now the nice thing about leopards of this age is they are quite busy. They are proper little busy bodies, and they will keep moving even when you think it's a bit too hot for them to be moving, but they have insatiable curiosity, and that's one of the most awesome things. I think young male leopards for me are incredible things to spend time with because they're always up to something, and hopefully he is going to spend quite a bit of time on Juma. Oh, he's gone right flat down. And as I said, he hasn't chosen the best place to sleep because that ground is very hot. Well, hello Dee from Delta. Dee would like to know, are the cubs now independent from their mothers, or is Karula still catching food for them? Karula is still definitely catching food for both of them. And she's probably going to still catch food for this guy for probably another year or maybe even a bit more. I wonder how long he's going to be able to last on that hot ground before he decides to move again. Last time was about 4 minutes, I think. Yeah, all the doves calling in the background as they come down towards the waterhole to drink. Hello, Sophie. Sophie is 5 years old and watching all the way from Moscow. Sophie would like to know which leopard's my favorite. That is a very difficult question, Sophie. I would think I do like Shongile a lot, but I'm still waiting to see how she grows into her personality. I think out of the young leopards, Shongile is my favorite. Oh, I don't know. Was Hosanna my favorite? I think they're Thai favorite out of the young leopards. But from the adult females, I think my favorite is Inkanyeni, the female leopard. And out of the adult males, I would have to say Quarantine. Quarantine's brother used to be my favorite, but we don't see him anymore. He's moved way down to the south. So while he snoozes, we're not going to move a muscle. We're going to stick here with him. But in the meantime, let's go see where Jamie is and what she's up to.
I'm actually going to skim past Brent, just to give you an idea of where we are. I think I can see him. Yes, I can see him. Here we go. Whoopsie, sorry. I accidentally moved forward there. Oh, there is, sorry Dave, that wasn't Dave's camera work, that was my moving forward completely unexpectedly. Sorry, my mistake. Now, you were talking about, or Brent was talking about, favorite leopards in answer to little Sophie's question. I was thinking about mine. You shouldn't really have favorites, and it's difficult to choose. It's difficult because, of course, we see the lovely Karula and her gorgeous cubs. We see them more often than I think we see any other leopard. And I'm just going to stop here and see, while I talk about this, whether or not there's anything living in this dead leadwood. Is there anybody home? Such a perfect hidey hole, so many perfect hidey holes for nesting birds and squirrels and lizards and snakes and all sorts of things, and of course none of them are here. But it was a nice idea, but unfortunately I don't see anything living in this particular ancient tree that actually gives the road that I'm on, which is Leadwood Road, which actually gives the road Leadwood its name. Right, favorite leopards. I've spoken about this before. I think my favorite female leopard is Tundi. I don't know what it is about her. There's just something that I really... She's tiny. She's very spirited. And I think it was cemented when... Not that Karula wouldn't have done the same thing for her little ones. But the way in which she courageously rescued her cubs from that baboon troop that we all saw unfold live in front of us. I think that that was probably my favorite moment with her. And that really... It was a particularly impressive moment watching her problem solve and watching her think about how it would be that she could actually save her cubs and holding back, not running too fast, despite the risk to her own life while that male baboon was chasing her and basically distracting them, pulling off the road because there is a vehicle, a civilian vehicle approaching, and I'm just going to wait for them to come past us and move on. Males, I can't choose. Males, it's a difficult one. I have not actually spent enough time with any of the male leopards apart from Tingana. So I can't really, you know, I can't by proxy say that he's my favorite male leopard. There we go. We'll just wait for the dust clouds to settle. I must say that Shungile is going very high up there in terms of leopard characters. And we, of course, all love Queen Karula. That is an obvious, that's a given. Dave, what about your favorite? Oh, hold on, we're going to wait for Ephraim to come past too.
I quite like quarantine.
Yeah, he is gorgeous. I've only had a few brief sightings with him.
Hi.
Hello, Ephraim, how are you? Hi, guys. Sweet. I think that might have been a young family member there. Right, I'm going to carry on and I'm not going to... Oh, sorry, I thought you were a fly bug. I'm going to carry on and see what else we can find. In the meantime, let us head back over to Brent and one of our favourite leopard characters.
Well, his head's up. He's looking down to the south where his sister and mother apparently are. I'm hoping he spots a squirrel or something to stalk. Now, Alina's wondering if a leopard breaks its whiskers or lose them, do they grow back? I would expect they do, Alina, like the rest of their fur. They will grow back, maybe sometimes not as long as before, or maybe sometimes longer. So yes, they do grow back. Oh, hot kitty. Has he got a tick in the middle of his one spot there on his neck, Chandra? Mm. Or is that just a piece of stone from where he was lying?
Ew.
I think it's a stone. Oh, yeah. Jen in Missouri. Jen's wondering, would that this young male leopard act any differently if he had no clue where his mom is? Possibly, but he would still be as relaxed as he is with the vehicles. He's grown up with the vehicles. He might walk around calling softly, but even then that would only be after a couple of days. Generally only if they've been chased by lions or baboons or something like that. But normally he'll just wait for mom to find him. I hear some. Bird alarm calls up to the north. Nah, I think it's a false alarm. Stephen in the UK. Stephen would like to know, does a leopard's tail serve a purpose? Indeed it does, Stephen. It helps them with balance, number one. And also that white fluffy tip is a wonderful following mechanism for young leopards to follow their mothers. We're going to stick with him. Hopefully he finds something interesting to chase shortly. While we do that, Jamie's got something that will definitely want to avoid young Hosanna.
Hoppy, we have found a mammal, Dave. We are doing remarkably well this afternoon. Our mammal species seem to be hiding away from us today. I feel as though we're just having one of those days where the animals are completely evading us. But we have got this gorgeous young male in Yala, and he is providing us with... Never mind. I was about to say a lovely opportunity to have a look at the oxpeckers sitting on his back, at which point he promptly chased them away, which seems to be relatively par for the course this afternoon, doesn't it, Dave? Birds flying away, mammals playing games with us, stopping to nibble behind a tree where we can't see him. That is the joy of these live. It would be very boring if it was easy, wouldn't it? If it was all the easy way to go, we wouldn't be able to do it. It's a young male. He's just started to get the ivory tippings to his horns, and they haven't quite reached their full inward and outward curve. And he's also not fully as fluffy as a mature Nyala bull. Now, I did see one earlier. I think it's also a young male, though. And perhaps these gentlemen would be so kind as the temperature drops, perhaps they might think about sparring with each other. Here we go. Tails flicking. Sorry, just bear with me one moment. I just wanted to hear something again on the game drive comms. Ephraim for Jamie. Ephraim. Oh well, that's fine. I don't think he could hear me. He might be driving quite quickly. The wind might be blowing the sound of his game drive radio away from him. Right, I saw another young bull. There he is, there, nibbling away. Let's just give it a couple more seconds to see what these two do. They might decide to have a little game with each other. Nyala are quite playful antelope. They do often hop, skip, and jump around. Now, the first thing I'm going to do tomorrow morning on the Sunrise Safari, because this morning, of course, I was driving Alex around, so we were doing some behind-the-scenes filming of the vehicles. But the first thing I'm going to do tomorrow morning is stop on quarantine so that you can watch the baby impala play with each other. Because this morning they were head-butting each other and jumping. It looked like they were playing leapfrog with each other. And there's probably about easily 25 baby impala wandering around quarantine now. I think that's what my plan will be for early tomorrow morning. You want to get them... Oh, whoopsie. You got to get them before the temperature gets too warm. I'm saying whoopsie because I've been creating a traffic jam behind me. Don't either. Sorry, Dave. That's because I've parked us in a place where you can't see them. That is not your fault at all. They have actually moved into the dense vegetation of this drainage line. So they're hiding away. Let's go and see what else we can find along the eastern boundary of Juma. Perhaps we can stop off at the bush baby tree. Dave, you know the bush baby hole?
Yeah.
Remember the amazing moment where we stopped at the bush baby hole and the head popped up?
Oh,
yeah, exactly. Well, we stopped there the other night. Guess what popped its head out?
What?
A squirrel.
Okay.
A It was such a lovely surprise because we sat for ages waiting to see what would. And just as I was about to go, I saw movement and I thought, yes, we're going to get a repeat of the bush baby sighting. Nope. Squirrel. It was pretty cool. It was very cool. I definitely wasn't complaining. I was flummoxed, but I wasn't complaining. Are the joys of the unexpected out here. Here's another Inyala 5 kilometers away. Virginia, you wanted to know if I have seen Fang's herd and the little baby that we saw that was a few hours old. And just to give you some context to this, for those of you that missed that particular moment, I know not all of you can watch every day, although I'm pretty sure most of you have heard about it by now. Brent actually found a placenta, fresh placenta, from an elephant. And we just happened to be in the right place at the right time, and this little baby elephant came stumbling out of the bushes, still wobbly on its legs, still coated in afterbirth and various mucus substances. It was the most amazing sight, one of the most amazing sightings I've ever had. It actually left me really emotional, and I haven't. I know Taylor did a couple of days later. I know that she saw Fang's herd and that tiny baby. I haven't seen it since. And in fact, I was saying to Dave earlier, since I came back from leave, which was about 4 weeks ago, I've had one really nice elephant sighting, and that was in Buffleshoek. When we went to go and visit some friends and was a big old bull. I haven't seen elephants properly since. It's actually quite sad. I feel really, really bereft of the company of elephants. Somehow the space always feels slightly emptier when they're gone. And I mean, that's the way it should be. There's no fences. They should be gone. They should be where the best food is. But I do feel slightly saddened at their absence. They'll be back. We'll get to enjoy their company once again. They will be back. It's just a matter of waiting patiently for them to return to us. All right, guess what? Stopping at the bush baby tree, and guess what the first thing I've seen is? It is a squirrel, Dave. A bit to the left. There we go. Lying like a leopard. Across the branch. This is I say it's my bush baby tree. I saw bush babies here twice, and therefore it shall forever be ingrained as my bush baby tree. Much like the other one, despite the fact that now both times that I have checked, it's been occupied by squirrels. Hello, little squirrel. It's almost time for this little guy to be heading to bed, heading into the safety of the hole. And thank you to Cindy for sending through the screenshot of the little squirrel poking its head out of the hole. It was adorable, and it did have a very sleepy, very confused look to its face, or to its expression, as it popped its head out as if to say, "What's all this racket about? I'm trying to sleep." They are perhaps an underappreciated animal. I don't think we stop and enjoy squirrels nearly as often as we should. That's also because they don't keep still very often. And this is a reclining squirrel, which is rare. They're usually scampering about, dashing across in front of you and disappearing, or frantically alarm calling at something. But this one is relaxed and taking a moment to enjoy the beauty of the evening. Looks jolly comfortable, doesn't he, Dave? Or she. I think it might be a she. They always make those branches look so very comfortable. There are, however, no bush babies. Bush babies and squirrels will quite contentedly share trees. They won't sleep in the same holes. Although it is possible, because bush babies, of course, are active at night and squirrels during the day. So it is possible that you might get some overlap between sleeping holes. But generally, they'll just share separate sleeping holes in the same tree. And I definitely don't see any sign of bush babies coming out. Oh well, might be a bit early. No, this is actually perfect time for them to start waking up. Freya says that it is doing the mannequin challenge. I'm still not entirely sure exactly what the mannequin challenge is. Dave, can you explain it to me?
You just
freeze.
Frozen moment.
Yes, everything freezes in time. Okay, that makes sense. That makes sense. I guess everybody just goes very still. Most of our animals seem to be doing that today. They're doing the mannequin challenge on account of the heat. And in fact, I'm going to be doing the mannequin challenge in a few hours when I go to sleep. I'm not going to be moving. I'm going to be like a log. Yes, the mannequin challenge due to the heat. When slightly warm, I believe that Hosanna was doing quite a good impression of the mannequin challenge earlier as well. Oh, he blinked. You lose. It's like musical statues when we were kids. I can't remember if in musical statues you couldn't blink. I think you were allowed to blink. It depended on who was making the rules, I suppose. I think we should play musical statues more often. Oh. I think we should have a game of musical statues at DRC. You can see the mosquito buzzing around. It might actually be thinking about landing and having a bite to eat. We know the feeling, little squirrel. We know the feeling. There are lots and lots and lots. 'Tis the year of the mosquito this year. There seem to be more than I ever remember there being. Okay. Well, since our squirrel is doing such a fantastic mannequin challenge, I think it might be time for us to move off. And Catherine, you say at least he is a positive squirrel. Absolutely. Sorry, I have a good chuckle every time. After the negative squirrel of that Shungile and Hosanna caught and eventually managed to kill, a nice positive squirrel sighting is a positive thing indeed. The positive squirrel, by the way, stems from Sam, who was one of the presenters at Wild Earth. He was very much loved. And he described a pet squirrel called Monty, I believe it was, as being very positive. It was a very positive... Monty was a very positive squirrel. None of us are entirely sure what a positive squirrel means, but I like... Didn't that story have a really sad ending as well? Monty was a very positive squirrel, but... Yes, so Monty was a very positive squirrel, but unfortunately met a very negative end. And we will always think of Sam and the positive squirrel when we stop at the squirrels. The same as the black-headed oriole, I'll always think of Sam then as well. Ah, Sam. We need him to come back and share more of those lines with us. Okay, where to from here? This morning, this is where Tingari very kindly walked behind us over our tracks and casually padded away into Torchwood. We must have just missed him. All right, well, the rest of the mammal life seems to be evading us, apart from our positive squirrel. I think we should go back to Brent and see how Hassan is doing with his mannequin challenge.
Well, young Hosanna is battling the biting flies at the moment, and they seem to have found him, and he's just trying to get away from them. He's going to go into the thorns. I don't know if that's going to help with your biting fly problem, mister. Amazing how he's able to move through those prickly branches. Was he spotted his sister or his mother returning? It doesn't look like it. It just seems like he was trying to find a spot away from the biting flies. And you stood on a thorn. Oh, you got it out quite quickly though. You might go down for another drink. It is excruciatingly warm at the moment. Hi, Caroline. Caroline would like to know if I think he will allow me to approach him on foot. Well, Caroline, I have approached him on foot quite a few times. And as long as you don't go too close, he is quite a nice leopard to walk. But as soon as you get too close, he is going to run away. Okay, let's get down to where he is. I'm always keeping a lookout for either Karula or Shongile if they decide to wander through to join him. Hello, Mr. Man. There we go. That looks a little bit more comfortable than that warm, hot floor you were sleeping on. Hello, Anne in Canada. Anne is wondering about leopard spot patterns, and she'd like to know whether it's identified as a cub or when it's older. It's as a cub, Anne. It's not going to change as they get older. He's trying to find a cool spot to sleep. He's so hot. Shame, mister. Hot and all the stable flies are biting you. It's a tough day. Got bored waiting for mom. Okay, it looks like he might go have a drink. Let's just get around to the other side. Might be just looking for a cool place to sleep again. Yes, he is. Well, let's go around to the opposite side in case he does want to have a drink at a later stage. How's that, Chandra? Good. There he is. It's a little bit cooler down here. Seems he hasn't managed to rid himself of the biting flies that found him on top of the wall. Hi Freya, who's a new viewer, a big Safari Live. Welcome to you, Freya. Great to have you with us. Now Freya's asking, don't leopards live in trees? Well Freya, that's one of the big misconceptions. 99% of the time when you see a leopard, it is on the ground. Oh, I thought I heard something behind me. They only really climb into trees. Sometimes they'll go up when it's hot to get away from the heat. Maybe there's a slight breeze higher. What has he spotted? Is there anything behind me? I can't see what he's looking at. Well, he maybe just saw something. He's curious at this age. Now, as I was saying, they will generally only be in trees when they've put a kill up a tree. So there we go. Jean-André is being very creative. Sometimes they will use a tree as a vantage point while they're hunting, go up to see if there's any prey up ahead. But normally you will find leopards on the ground. Whatever caught his interest is no longer catching his interest. He's gone back down. Still sort of interested. I think he's heard something. Now he's disinterested. I'm just trying to keep quiet just to see if I could hear if Karula was contact calling. But I'm not hearing any contact calls from his mom. So she's probably still out hunting. Yoli would like to know, why won't Hisana cool down in the water that he's lying right next to? Well, Yoli, it's a very, very simple answer to that question, is that he's grown up in Africa, and most bodies of water in Africa have crocodiles in it. So instinctively, leopards, lions, and most cats will try to stay out of the water. Now, there are leopards that leopards can swim and will swim when they have to, but if they have a choice to, they won't. They have an inherent fear of water due to crocodiles. Now, it all depends on the area as well. So leopards that live in the great rainforests of Africa, in the Congo Basin, Gabon, Central African Republic, will actually swim quite regularly because they have to. It's the only way to get from point A to B. But in the real thick forests and the forest lakes, there are not many Nile crocodiles. You get slender-snouted crocodiles and dwarf crocodiles would actually leopard prey on quite frequently. So, in areas where there are a lot of Nile crocodiles, leopards will try avoid water at all costs. But they can swim, they just don't like doing it. And particularly in this area, there's not nearly enough water for them to swim regularly. Or not nearly enough water for them to be forced to swim regularly. We're going to sit here, see if his sister or mother arrives or if he disappears. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
And that is the joy, of course, of a wonderful evening like this evening or any evening time in the bush. As it starts to get dark, one is always filled with that slight sense of expectation and excitement about what the evening is going to hold. And of course, as Brent and James describe it, the changing of the guard occurs round about now as the diurnal animals start to go to sleep and the nocturnal animals start to stir. Now, one of those nocturnal animals is a genet. We've actually got two species of genet here. We've got large spotted and we've got small spotted genets. I've never seen a small spotted genet here. I have in other areas, but never here. The reason I'm mentioning genets is because recently we have been enjoying dinner at the Voyatella Lodge. We've been sharing it with our special guests. We're not sharing the lodge, we've been moving and having dinner with our special guests there. And there is a genet that lives in the roof. And the genet that lives in the roof, very often you look up at breakfast and you can just see the tail dangling down from the gap in the thatch. But the night before last, this particular genet decided to descend whilst just before we were all about to have dinner. And it went for a little walk along the table. It's completely used to people. It's a genet that's become habituated to people in the lodge. It's not a pest, it's not a danger, and it's not dangerous to it. If we were trying to approach it, it would run away. But it gave everybody the most amazing view of this genet as it stalked along the dinner table with delicate steps. A genet, by the way, looks like, I always think it looks like a mixture between a mongoose and a cat, a domestic cat. It's a long, strange-looking animal that is actually in its own family completely closely related to mongoose, or at least related to mongoose if you go back in the evolutionary line, but it's not a mongoose. And they're very, very pretty animals. They've got very striking spotted markings. Anyway, this particular genet proceeded to give us an amazing demonstration of its climbing skills, weaving and bobbing and weaving inside and around the thatched, it's a thatched roof, so it's sort of curved upwards with wooden beams that run along the top of it. Let's go over to Brent.
Okay, guys, we rushed back. Look at this. That impala hasn't even seen him, and it's going to be very interesting to see. It's an adult female impala, if he makes a play at that. Now, that impala has not seen him at all. It's walked down to come have a drink. He hasn't moved. He's probably about 9-10 meters. It's running towards him. It still hasn't seen him. Now this might be a bit big for him. Oh, maybe he got a sixth sense that something's up. Now that impala is still around, I can't see it. I think it's behind a bush. We're not going to move the vehicle. Now, it would have been really interesting if a baby impala had come with her. He's probably strong enough to take down an adult female impala. It might be a bit of a challenge for him. Oh, look at his ears turn as soon as he heard baboons in the distance. He doesn't like baboons. Those of you might remember that he nearly got caught by baboons when you were watching with James. Let's just go back a little bit. I think that impala has decided it's safer to go drink elsewhere. But I think that impala probably could smell him, but couldn't see him. Just want to see where that impala is. Still there. It's going back towards the water. The next set of water. Okay, he's after it. There we go. He's using that dam wall. The impala's just on the other side. There we go. Now keep your head down, Nana. Other way. Left, left. Are you going to get spotted, mister? Yes, impala's just to the left. There we go, look at him go. So that impala's directly behind him now. It looks like he might be trying to utilize the available cover to get closer to that impala. Okay, let's just get into a good spot. So, this is really exciting. Now, this is what young leopards do when their mom's away. Now, even if this hunt is a failure, it's practice, practice, practice makes perfect. So, from his position, we're just going to drive past him so we don't attract attention to him. From his position, it's going to be very difficult now because there's only this very limited bit of cover. And that impala can definitely smell something's wrong. So there's the impala. Oh, yes, there we go. Did he pop his head up? But she can smell. You can just see she smelt him. She smelt him. And I think he missed his moment when she was at the waterhole, because that was the only time he was close enough to make that pounce. See, when she ran away, he's just laid up on top of the damn wall now, given up. Maybe he should stick to squirrels for a little longer. So we're going to leave him shortly. His mom's not here. It's getting dark. We're not going to put any spotlights on him. So that was a really exciting little period there. I thought he might pounce on his first big kill. Wouldn't that have been exciting? Mike says, from a squirrel to an impala, what a change in 1 week. Yes, I think he's probably chased quite a few impala with little success. I think he's definitely probably very, very scary for the squirrels still. I think another couple of months before he's really scary for impala. Okay, Mr. Hassana, thank you very much for keeping us entertained. As I said, getting quite dark now, so I'm going to leave him be. And
carry on to see what else we can find in the last section of the show. But while we do that, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Well, I am busy searching for nocturnal beasties. I have to finish off this Jenna story now. But we got distracted by Hosanna hunting that impala. Very courageous attempt on his part, by the sounds of it. But I was telling you the story of the Jennet. And the reason I have to finish the story of the Jennet was where it was going. Was it wandered across the table. So I told you all about it was climbing through the beams of the house. It wandered through the table and deposited a present on the edge of the table. It very kindly deposited not actually on the edge of the table, sort of towards the end, but right in the middle. I'm not sure whether James looked at it for too long or something, you know, he always jokes about animals and their tendency to defecate in front of him. Well, this Jenna defecated in the middle of the table. And everybody just stared at it in absolute horror, as you can imagine. I just thought it was, it's the joys of the African bush. It doesn't matter how fancy and prepared you are. A lot of the time, the animals have a slightly different idea. And we've seen it with so many different things, whether it was the jennet relieving itself on the dining room table, or it is the moth that decides it really absolutely has to have a sip of some guest's very expensive Merlot. There's always something thoroughly entertaining, or perhaps a beetle flying straight and smacking somebody in the face while you're driving about at night. It doesn't matter how much you fork out for a safari, whether it's an expensive lodge or a reasonable lodge, the chances are at some point an animal is going to do something thoroughly entertaining and very interesting, and hopefully, if you are in the right state of mind, highly amusing. I thought it was funny anyway. Right, let us see what we can find. Ah, now Lenny in Pennsylvania, you want to know what happens if lions show up for a dinner. It has happened before, it has happened quite a few times in my past. Generally, if it's a bush dinner, which I have hosted a few of, I think we've all hosted a few of, and a pride of lions show up, the general course of action is to say, would everybody please get into the vehicles? And I'm sure you sort of evacuate everybody relatively rapidly. I'm sure there are a few pictures of lions joining the breakfast table. I have seen from years ago, there was a picture of a lion that had gone up to a drink stop and was giving the gin bottle a cursory lick just to see what it tastes like. I wonder if she liked it. So yes, it does happen. I've had lions show up at dinners. I've had hyenas are par for the course because hyenas are curious, so they're often around. Hyenas are fine though, you just chase them off. As long as you spot them, they're not a problem. There are, of course, many famous Kruger Park stories. There's one where a leopard wandered into a picnic site and joined a family for breakfast. The family watching from a slightly shocked and safe distance. It then proceeded to eat the bacon off the barbecue, or braai, as it's officially known. What else have I had raid dinner parties? Elephants. I've had elephants come wandering in, having a sniff at what we're doing. I have had, what else has happened? I think those are the main creatures that have shown up uninvited. It's quite rude when you think about it. They haven't been extended an invitation, but then again, we are having our dinner parties in the middle of their home. So I guess maybe not so rude. It's the joys of living in the bush. I once had mating rhinos join me at a dinner. We were actually doing a sleep out. So we were sleeping out underneath the stars with people keeping watch to make sure, because it's very dangerous to sleep out in the open unless you are watching throughout the night. You cannot have everybody asleep at the same time. But that particular evening, all sitting down to dinner, and we could actually feel the thud of their feet. Because what rhino do when they're courting is the female rejects the male for about 2 weeks as she comes into estrus, as she comes into heat. And we just heard female trotting past, followed by a very amorous male. And not to be deterred, the female changed direction and came running past the opposite side. And our guest sitting perplexed in the middle. It happens. Of course, all of the time, we will always err on the side of absolute caution. So if there is any kind of a danger, you just get everybody back in the vehicles. Now, Dave, we have a new challenge. So, the chameleon challenge. Well, it's actually not a challenge, it's a punishment. And I haven't actually told any of the other presenters. So by we have a new challenge, I mean I've invented a new rule. As of a few days ago, not as of right now. So essentially, because both Brent and I in the same evening both thought we saw a chameleon, and both of us turned out to be mistaken, there should be a chameleon, a communal chameleon jar. So when you're not live, it doesn't count. But if you're live and you happen to spot something that you think is a chameleon and it's a false alarm, then you have to put 10 rand in the chameleon jar.
I like it.
And the person who sees an actual chameleon gets the spoils of the chameleon jar. There's a chance we're going to lose signal here. I'm going to try and go through quickly. All right, I think what we'll do is while we go through this dip, let's head back over to Brent and find out what his plans are.
Well, we're going to keep looking for all sorts of little nocturnal creatures, although I think we need a little bit more rain to really bring the chameleons out. But the wonderful thing about being live is you never know what's around the next corner. Now, hopefully, Krula is unsuccessful in her hunting down to the south of us and comes back to the north, and hopefully young Hassan will be in the same area on the Sunrise Safari as well. Hello, Delara. Wonderful to have you with us. Delara is a new viewer, says, I wish I found this channel earlier. What a wonderful way to learn about the animals. Well, Delara, we welcome you into the Safari Live family, and hopefully you'll be sending lots of questions, and hopefully we can help you learn about Africa's wonderful wildlife. Scrub here, we'll just turn the lights off so he doesn't run in front of us. I've got a little hare, there he goes. Now, I'm hoping maybe to find a nightjar or two. So far, we've only found, since we've started hearing and seeing them again, we've only found the fiery necked nightjar in. And I'm hoping maybe we can find a square-tailed as well. Now one has to wonder whether our hyenas are going to start coming back now that the Nkuhumas are on mobile again, and I think only time is going to be able to tell, but it would be nice to have the hyena den back on Juma. And hello, Emmett. And Emmett is Shirley's son, who would like to know, do we have any crows here? We do. We don't see them too often. We have a couple of different species of crows and ravens. The only crow I've seen in the Sabi Sands is the pied crow. So it's a big crow with a white neck. I thought I saw an owl fly through there. Did he land in this little dip? I'm hoping. Quite a big owl, probably a spotted eagle owl. Normally at this time of the day, they like to perch quite conspicuously, try catch the first little mice and things that are going to be coming out. But I just saw him fly through and I was hoping he would have landed somewhere here, like there. Alas, no sign. Checking all the big dead trees. That's where owls would like to land at this time of the evening. And it looks like that owl flew straight through. Well, it's been wonderful having you with us on this sunset safari. Started off a little slow, but fortunately, young Hassana made an appearance. Hopefully, he'll be in the same place tomorrow morning. So we will be seeing you bright and shiny and early tomorrow morning for your sunrise safari. So from Jandre and myself, we're going to say toodaloo and pass you back to Jamie.
Toodaloo? I haven't heard anybody say toodaloo in a very long time. I don't think I've said toodaloo since I was about 10. Dave, have you said toodaloo on any kind of regular basis?
Many times.
Many times. Okay, I take that back. Perhaps Dave has many times said toodaloo. It's obviously one of Brent's... It is better than toodles. Kirsty raises a good point. It is probably better than toodles. But I also can't say anything because I've found myself often saying whoopsie daisy. Which often afterwards I stop and I look back and I go, whoopsie daisy. Anyway, it works. Apparently Brent does it as well. I'm glad that Hosanna decided to make an appearance and pop out of the woodwork and save our cat streak, at least for now. Hopefully by tomorrow morning sunrise safari, the royal family entire will be back on Juma. And of course the Nkuhumas as well, I'm hoping, will decide to make a return to us once again. Dave, is it a good afternoon back?
Lovely.
A lovely afternoon. Quiet but lovely, I feel. It's always wonderful, even if you don't necessarily see or have an action-packed safari, it's still wonderful to drive around and just appreciate the sheer beauty of where we are. And the smells, the build of a potential storm, although I think that's blown away now, but the potential storm. The exciting prospect of new surprises around every corner. Mysterious birds. Mysterious birds that don't want to be on camera. Check my other bush baby tree. No, nobody's home. Apparently you're all saying toodaloo to each other and to us. Well, I'd better not break with that tradition then when it does come to the end of our safari. Heard you say toodaloo.
I've seen
at least 4 times in the last 5 days. Okay, that's not just a surprise word. That's a genuine language use. Okay, fair enough. Well, I'm glad we've said hello to you, Dave, today, and not toodaloo. And on that slightly bizarre note, it is the end of our live safari. And you will have to join us again on the Sunrise Safari to find out what mysteries have unfolded during the African night. But for now, it is time to say our goodbyes and our thank yous. So a big thank you to Dave and a big welcome back to not only to Dave, although welcome back, Dave, to Kirsty, to Connor, to Lou, and to Taylor tomorrow. But we'll get there. We will get there. there eventually. So thank you to Dave for his wonderful camera work. Thank you to Kirsty and Jerry in final control, and all of the team working behind the scenes to bring you these live safaris. Most importantly, a big thank you to all of you joining us wherever you happen to be. Thank you for your questions.